Hello. So today we will discuss block three, metaphysical poets. Okay. So last two class we have covered block one and block two, Chaucer's age from 1340 to 1400 and Elizabethan age 1558 to 1603. Okay. So 1603 to 1625 is popularly known as Jacobian age. James, reign of James West. Okay. Then from 1625 to 1649, the age was popularly known as Charles West Age, Age of Charles West or Carolian Age. Then, let me tell you something. In 1642, civil war broke out in England. In 1649, Charles West was beheaded. Then Oliver Cromwell came into power. 1649 to 1660 is known as period of Commonwealth, age of Commonwealth. Then from 1660 to 1685 is known as Restoration Age. Restoration Age, because Charles II was restored to the monarchy. That is why the age is known as Restoration Age, 1660 to 1685. Then 1685 to 1688 is known as James II age. Okay. So, anyway, lot of England has witnessed lot of political changes during this period. Almost most of the poet who lived in 17th century, they have lived through the reign of somewhat three or five kings. Okay. Now, just a second. I'm going to present. You may switch off your camera. Okay. Can you see the slides? Hello? Are you able to see the slides?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
If you are not able, please do inform me. I will present it again. One second. Okay. One second. So I've already told you, so in this class, we will discuss block three, metaphysical poetry. So what is metaphysical poetry? Do you have any idea about metaphysical poetry? Many of you have learned metaphysical poetry in your lower classes. I mean, in degree classes, you might have learned metaphysical poetry, at least about John Donne, Andrew Marvell and all. Anyone? What is metaphysical poetry? What is metaphysical? What's the meaning of the term metaphysical?
Excuse me. Good morning, ma'am. Something philosophical, something beyond the physical.
Yes, it is. Metaphysical means beyond physical. The term metaphysical poetry is used to refer to the poetry of 17th century poets such as John Donne, Andrew Marvell, George Herbert, Richard Crashaw, Abraham Cowley, Henry Vaughan, John Cleveland, Thomas Strahan. So these are the popular metaphysical poets of the 17th century. Let me tell you, these poets have lived through the reign of James West, Charles West, and Oliver Cromwell. So many of these, please note that. Okay. They have they were in the Jacobian age also, Charles Carolian age, then in Oliver Cromwell's period. Okay, so they have lived through reign of three kings: John Donne, Andrew Marvell, George Herbert, Richard Crashaw, Abraham Cowley, Henry Vaughan, John Cleveland, Thomas Strahan. Okay, let me tell you something. You didn't have to study the poems of all these poets. We have only John Donne, Andrew Marvell, and George Herbert in the first three poets in this block. Okay. One second. Yeah. Now, let's see what's the definition of what is metaphysical poetry. The term metaphysical poet was coined by the critic Samuel Johnson. Okay, please note it. It was coined by Samuel Johnson to describe the group of 17th century poets whose work were characterized by following. See, all these poets have similar features in their poetry. So when you write an essay on metaphysical poetry, obviously sometimes you will get a 20 mark question, write an essay on metaphysical poetry. So you have to write all these points. The inventive use of conceits, argumentative and rational in approach, highly intellectualized themes, complex and unique ideas, strange imagery, paradox, colloquial diction, dramatic expression, irony, pun, wit, metrical flexibility, highly lyrical stanza. So these are the features of metaphysical poetry. So let me tell you, see, these poets are entirely different from Elizabethan and Elizabethan poets. Okay, Elizabethan poets mainly revolves poetry mainly revolves around love, court, other chivalry themes. But this one is a bit scientific in approach. Okay, and their themes were very complex and unique. Okay, then. So Samuel Johnson was a popular critic of 18th century. He once said about the metaphysical poets that most heterogeneous ideas are yoked by violence together, so has to make a point clear. So, I mean, those comparison that metaphysical poets makes in their poetry, that will be far-fetched ideas, yoked together, yoked by violence together. Okay. There won't be any kind of similarity between the things that they compare. Sometimes they'll be comparing with lovers with that of compass. Do we have any similarity between compass and lovers? No, we don't have any similarity. Similarly, love and mosquito, love and a flea. Do we have any similarity? What about a robe, a cloth and a god? Do we have any similarity? No, we don't have any kind of, usually in Elizabethan poetry, the common comparison that they make are rose, roses or tiger, these kind of common similarity. But comparison used by metaphysical poets are far-fetched. That is why Samuel Johnson defined metaphysical poetry as the most heterogeneous ideas yoked by violence together. Why they are doing? Because in order to make a point clear. So they are a bit scientific in approach. Ooh, metaphysical poet, scientific in approach. See this, highly intellectualized themes, argumentative. And most of the poems of John Donne, George Herbert, Andrew Marvell, all those poets, they have a tendency to argue. Argue in their poetry. Either they'll be arguing with their beloved or with their friend or to a speaker. Okay. So their poetry is written in the form of an argument. Okay. Then John Donne, especially in canonization, he has started the poetry in the form of dramatic monologue. I hope you know what a dramatic monologue is. Sudden. Starting, abrupt starting. Now, next one. Yeah. Then their diction. That won't be flowery. In else, you have learned Chaucer's poetry and Spencer's poetry. You have come across the language and their diction. It's very flowery, right? But metaphysical poets, they use colloquial language. Colloquial. And they have their poems are full of what? Irony, pun, wit, and they have used different types of meters. The meter that they employed in their poetry range is from iambic trimeter to iambic hexameter. Not like Chaucer and Spencer. They haven't gone beyond iambic pentameter, but in the poems of John Donne, Andrew Marvell, George Herbert, you can see they have used iambic trimeter to iambic hexameter. then okay, and the most popular feature, the most important feature of metaphysical poetry is metaphysical conceit. I told you what a metaphysical conceit is. That is a far-fetched comparison, an extended comparison. Okay, common themes of metaphysical poetry: spiritual and religious sentiments, carpe diem, Platonic love, sex, philosophical and complex thought, and human existence. So these are the major themes of metaphysical poetry. Please note it. In John Donne's poetry, you can see spiritual and religious element, and Platonic love, sex, and all. In Andrew Marvell's theme poetry, you can see carpe diem. Of course, you can see spiritual and religious elements, then sex. In George Herbert's poetry, you can only see philosophy, complex, and religious themes because he was a priest. Now let's see what a metaphysical conceit is. It is a unique quality of metaphysical poetry. It is the comparison of two dissimilar things which may have very little in common. I told you these poets have a tendency to compare to dissimilar things. So for example, Compass conceit in Valediction Forwarding Morning, where a poet has compared lovers to the two legs of Compass. In Elizabethan era, the normal tendency of the poets is they will be comparing lovers to that of a rose, dove, birds, like that. But metaphysical poets, their comparison we cannot predict. So now moving on to John Donne, father. So John Donne is known as the father of metaphysical poetry. Okay. So John Donne's poetical works are noted for their metaphorical and sensual style. He's very sensual and erotic. His works include sonnet, love poems, religious poem, Latin translation, epigrams, elegies, sermons, satire. He reluctantly became a cleric in the Church of England. Let me tell you something. Actually, this person has three phases in his life. At first, he was a libertine. He was a womanizer. After that, he fell in love with his wife. I mean, Anne Moore, his wife. She died. After her death, he became a priest. He was forced to become a priest. Okay. Then he became a member of parliament in 1601. His patron's name is Sir Robert Drury. Okay. Now, let's see the characteristics of Donne's poetry. Class, are you following me? Hello, can you hear me?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So, characteristics of Donne's poetry. Donne's style is characterized by abrupt openings and various paradoxes, ironies, dislocation of everyday speech, and tense syntax. So you won't see, if you're reading Donne's poetry, you won't get the feel that you are reading a poetry. You will just feel that you are just hearing an argument of a familiar person. He's always arguing for his love or something that he believes in. Okay, he wrote as a reaction against smoothness of the conventional Elizabethan poetry. So let me tell you, metaphysical poetry, the tradition is a reaction against Elizabethan poetry. Important themes, I have already told you, religion, love, sex, and complex philosophy. So he has written secular poem as well as erotic and love poems. So this person, who is known as the father of metaphysical poetry, John Donne is known as the father of metaphysical poetry. Now, let's discuss the first poem, Canonization by John Donne. Let me tell you, in this section, in this block, we have 27 poems. It is pretty difficult to cover each and every. Anyway, let's cover as much as possible. For God's sake, hold your tongue and let me love. For chide my palsy or my gout, my five gray hairs or ruined fortune plot, with wealth your state, your mind with arts improve. Take you a course, get you a place, observe his honor or his grace, all things or the king's real or his stamped face. Contemplate what you will. Approve so you will let me love. See, have you seen the first two lines? For God's sake, hold your tongue. So this is like a dramatic, the poem is written in the form of a dramatic monologue. What do you mean by a dramatic monologue? In dramatic monologue, see, poem will be written in the form of dialogues. Someone will be speaking to, poet will be speaking to someone else. A listener will be there, but the listener will be passive. You got it? What are the features of dramatic monologue? I'm repeating. Poem will be written in the form of dialogues. It will be like a dialogue. Then the poet will be speaking to a passive listener. There will be a passive listener. Okay. Okay. Now, for God's sake, hold your tongue. Let me love or chide my palsy or my God. So in the first line, poet is arguing to his friend, who is advising him against loving and more. So he's asking his friend, please don't advise me. You can advise me on many other things, like you can advise me upon my disease or my growing age or about my ruined fortune. You have n number of things to advise. Better leave me. Don't advise me about my love. Okay. You better take a course and you may please get a place in the palace. From there you can observe king. Or king's stamped face. That means a king's stamped face means coin, money. If you're serving king, you will get money. In that coins, you can see the stamped face of king. Contemplate what you will approve. So you will let me love. So in the first stanza, poet is arguing with his friend, who is advising him not to love, because he's advised. So the poet says that I don't want to take any advice from you, because you can advise me about many other things. I'm suffering from palsy. I have gout. I have gray hairs. Many other things. Better don't advise me in the case of, in this matter. You better mind your own business. You better improve your financial condition. Okay. Or you better get a place in the palace. You serve the king. You can amass money. Or do whatever you want. Please let me love. That's the very meaning of the first stanza. It's very easy. Alas, alas, who enjoyed by my love? What merchant ships have my sighs drowned? Who says my tears have overflowed his ground? When did my cold's forward spring remove? When did the heat switch my veins fill? Add one more to the plague bill. Soldiers find wars and lawyers find out still. Litigious men and which quarrels move, though she and I do love. So in the second stanza again, alas, alas, who is injured by my love? What merchant ship have what merchant ship have my sighs drowned? So can you spot any of the figurative language over there? Alas, alas, who injured my love? What merchant ships have my sighs drowned? Can you spot any figurative language over there? Try. Hello?
Is it a metaphor, ma'am?
Oh. No, that's not a metaphor. Alas, alas, who injured by my love? What merchant ships have my sighs drowned? Who says my tears have overflowed his ground? When did my cold's forward spring remove? When did the heat switch my veins fill? Add one more to the plague bill. Soldiers find wars, lawyers find out still. Litigious men which quarrels move, though she and I do love. So in the second stanza, poet is asking to his friend, see, who is injured by my love? Of course, I and my beloved, we are in love. We love each other very much. And who is injured by our love? Do we have drowned any merchant ship because of our size? Any merchant ship have been drowned? Again, he's asking, has my tears overflowed any ground? Again, he's asking, does the cold of my love has advanced the spring, advance or what? Postpone the spring. When did the heat which my veins feel? Again, he's asking, does the heat of my love has put anyone to ill? Anyone ill? Soldiers, they're still finding wars. Soldiers, they are still fighting. Lawyers, they are still getting clients. World is moving as usual. Nothing on earth has been changed due to my love. Everything, I mean, everything on earth, each and every person is leading their normal life. Nothing on earth is affected by my love. So why are you making such a mess? Okay. So what it could be? Entire stanza has got hyperbole. I think you are familiar with hyperbole. That is exaggeration. Is it possible for size to drown a ship? Is it possible for the size to drown a ship? No, it's not possible. Now, is it possible for the tears to overflow the ground? No. Similarly, can cold and heat of love, is it possible for a cold, if either of the lovers, if they are getting a cold, or if they are not okay with each other, is it, can that prepone or postpone the spring seasons? No, it's not possible for the emotional changes in the lovers to postpone or prepone the spring, isn't it? Similarly, if they are in very much intimated with each other, then heats of their love will not put anyone in bed. Okay, soldiers, they are still fighting. They are still fighting. Then lawyers, they are still getting the clients. Nothing on earth is affected by their love. So what's the big deal? Why are you advising me against love and or love making? Let me love. Is it clear? Is the second stanza clear?
Hello? Ma'am, could you tell me the page number, ma'am?
Oh, page number. Let me check.
It's on page 32.
Okay, I don't have the text right now. Once again. Can you see the slide? Is it possible for you to see the slide?
Yes, ma'am. It's in volume number 2, page number 132. This poem is on page number 132.
Thank you. So you can see hyperbole. Hyperbole in second stanza. First stanza, it's in the kind of form of dramatic monologue. He's arguing with his friend. Now, call us what you will. We are made such by love. Call her one, me another fly. We tapers too, and at our own cost die. We in us find the eagle and dove. The phoenix riddle hath more wit. By us, we two being one are it. So to one neutral thing, both sexes fit. We die and rise the same and prove mysterious by this love. So, poet again argues that you can call me whatever name you want. Call me one fly. Call me a fly and my beloved another fly. We are candles too. We are tapers means we are candles too. That when you lit a candle, obviously it will melt down. So, lovers are like that. They are burning in their own love. They are just like flies. When they get, flies usually get attracted to candle light, right? And when they come near to the candle light, of course they will die at the cost, margin of the candle, at the edges of the candle you can see the flies. Similarly, the poet argues with his friend that you can call me whatever name you want. Call me one fly and my beloved another fly. We are candles too, just like a candle. We are melting in our own love. We in us find eagle and dove. We are also eagle and dove. So eagle shows the ferocious quality of love. And dove is the sophisticated side of love. You got it. Another comparison is eagle is the poet, dove is the beloved. Eagle is the poet, dove is the beloved. Phoenix riddle hath more wit. By us, we two being one are it. So to one neutral thing, both sexes fit. We die and rise the same and prove mysterious by this love. So this is the metaphysical conceit. Can you see this? Phoenix riddle. Phoenix riddle is the metaphysical conceit. I told you what a metaphysical conceit is. Metaphysical conceit is an unusual comparison, comparing two dissimilar things. Far-fetched. It will be far-fetched. See, it will be something different than the normal comparison. See, in Elizabethan poetry, is it possible to find a phoenix comparison? No, you can see lovers are compared to dove, other lovebirds and all. But you cannot see lovers are compared to phoenix. So here the poet says that the phoenix will have more wit. By us, we two being one. Okay, we are two. Yes, we are male and female. We are two separate bodies. But we are fused. Our heart, our souls are fused just like a phoenix bird. Because phoenix bird, it's a mythical bird, believed to be,
rise from its own ashes.
Yeah. Rises from its ashes, but the bird is believed to be live in the Arabian deserts. And the bird combines male and female in it. Okay, phoenix bird combines male and female sex in it. And at the end of its lifespan, it burns its own body, then it rises from the ashes. That's the riddle of the phoenix. So poet says that he and his beloved are just like a phoenix bird. They are not two. They are not two, but they are one, just like a phoenix bird, which combines female and male in it. At the end of their lifespan, they too will die like a phoenix bird, but for sure they will rise. And will make the story mysterious, just like a phoenix bird. That is why the comparison is said to be metaphysical conceit. See, the comparison and the very idea is very complex, right? It's a very complicated theory, isn't it? So please note this. This is the metaphysical conceit in the poem. I hope it is clear. Is there any doubt in the third stanza?
No, ma'am.
Okay. So we can die by it, if not live by love. And if unfit for tombs and hearse, our legends be. It will be fit for verse. And if no piece of chronicle we prove, we will build in sonnet pretty rooms, as well as well-wrought urn becomes the greatest ashes as half-acre tombs. And by these hymns, all shall prove a scan nice for love. So again, the poet says that, see, we will die for love if we are not able to live for love. If our story is unfit for a tomb, just like Shah Jahan built in half acre land, Taj for Mumtaz, isn't it? Shah Jahan has built Taj Mahal for his beloved wife, Mumtaz. So if our story is unfit for a tomb or a epic poetry, our legends be, it will be fit for verse. Of course, then we will find our place in poetry, poems. If no piece of chronicle we prove, we will win sonnet's pretty room. See, if no one is writing chronicles or epic poems or like that, then of course we will be happy with our stories in sonnets, 14 line poems. We don't have any problem. Spencer has written a long poem, isn't it, for his beloved. Then Iliad and Homer, Iliad and Odyssey, like that. If no one is there to write chronicles about our love story, then also we don't have any problem. We will be pretty happy with our places in the sonnets. 14 lines poem. Okay, as well as a well-wrought urn becomes the greatest ashes as half-acre tombs, and by these sins all shall approve a scan dies for love. So these sonnets, 14 lined poems will serve as a well-wrought urn. I hope you understood what a well-wrought urn is. A well-wrought urn, an urn is something that we collect ashes. After the death of the person, we will cremate him, then the ashes will be collected in the urn, isn't it? Then those ashes will be immersed in the holy river, isn't it? So let me tell you, most of the, you can see, most of the poets, English poets, are well versed in Hindu mythology and Sanskrit and all. So you somewhere here and there you can see some Hindu philosophy and all. So poet here says that if we cannot live for love, we will die for it. If our story is not that fit to make a tomb, then also we are happy. We'll be pretty happy with our places in small poetry. If no one is writing chronicles or legends or epic poetry, then also we don't have any problem. We will be pretty happy with our places in sonnets, 14-lined poems. That 14-line poem is as what? As pretty as ash collected in well-wrote urn. As collected in well-wrote urn. Okay, ash. So that well-wrote urn is as great as tomb built in half-acre land. See, eminent people, when they die, their tomb will be erected in a half-acre lands or acre of 1 acre land. We don't have any problem. This pretty sonnet is enough to, that will perpetualize our love. Okay. And by these hymns, all shall approve us canonized for love. And that 14-line poem will serve as a hymn. Hymn means a devotional poem. I mean, those sonnets which have been written for poet and his beloved, that will later will become a devotional poem. And when people will sing that, they will be canonized. He and his beloved will become saints of love. Canonized. They will be canonized for love. See, lots of, isn't it? Okay. 1 second. We do have lots of saints, isn't it? So many people have been canonized for their charity, for their faith in God and all. But these two people will be canonized for their love. So fourth stanza, is it clear to you? Fourth stanza. Is there any doubt?
Ma'am.
Okay. Yes, clear, ma'am.
Now we're moving on to the last stanza. And thus invoke us, you whom reverent love made one another's hermitage, you to whom love was peace that now is rage, who did the whole world's soul contract and drew into glass of your eyes, so made such mirrors and such spies that they did all to you epitomize countries, towns, courts, back from above a pattern of your love. So I told you in last stanza, the people will use those hymns to praise and canonize beloved and poet. So in fifth stanza, poet is saying that in future, people or the future generation will invoke them, will pray to them, will pray to poet and his beloved, because now they have been canonized. Now they are not ordinary people. They have been elevated. Their position has been changed. Previously, they were ordinary people. When they die, people will sing the sonnet they have written. And that sonnet will serve as a devotional song or a hymn or a prayer. And they will thus pray to poet and beloved. See? You whom reverent love made one another's hermitage. Actually, poet and beloved has made their world in each other's body. You to whom love was peace, that is now a rage. For them, love was a peace. But after they have shown a model to the people, now it has spread like a rage, a passion. Here, rage is passion, not anger. Now is rage. Who did the whole world's soul's contract and drew into glass of your eyes? So poet and beloved, they can see the world in each other's eyes. They don't need a mirror. They can see the entire world in each other's eye. So made such mirrors and such spies that they did all to you epitomize. So entire world is taking them as a model. Countries, towns, courts, back from above, a pattern of your love. I mean, people from countries, village, towns, courts, fashionable people, dignified people, then rustic people, all will come in front of poet and beloved who have been canonized for their love. They will pray in front of them to bless them to be successful in their love. That's a very summary of canonization. Okay, I hope you understood the poem. So let me tell you, he has treated a profane theme here. Actually, he is dealing with not love, lovemaking. So his friend is against that. Okay, so he's arguing with his friend. Why are you advising me in this matter? See, you have n number of things to advise. You can advise about my condition, physical condition, or about my ruined fortune, anything else. Or else you may please mind your own business. You go and get a place in King's Court. No one in this world is affected by my love. Everyone is happy with their life. So why are you advising me? Then he says that if I cannot live for love, then we will die for it. We are candles, we are flies, which will die for our love. Then he compares he and himself and his beloved to that of a phoenix, which has combined male and female sex in it. At the end of the lifespan, they will burn and will rise again. So thus rised poet and beloved will become saints of love, and people in the future generation will pray to them so has to bless them to be bless them, okay, so that they will become successful in their love. That's the main theme of the that's the main gist of this poem. And so this person has got a peculiar capacity to treat even a profane theme as divine. Okay, profane, you know, what's the meaning of the term profane? So in most of his poem, by love, what he means is love making. We know that during 17th century or in any century, let it be any century, okay, love making before marriage is profane. But this person can change that into divine. Now, next poem. Valediction forbidding morning. As virtuous men pass mightily away and whisper to their souls to go, while some of their sad friends do say, breath goes now, and some say no. So the second poem, valediction forbidding morning. Here he is speaking to his beloved. In canonization, he is speaking to his friend. In this poem, he is speaking to his beloved. He is actually advising his beloved. As virtuous men passes mildly away and whispers to their soul to go, while some of the sad friends do say, the breath goes now, and some say no. So here he says that when virtuous people, when great people, when they pass away from earth, when they die, they will die without making any noise, without making any fuss. Of course, their friends will become very sad when their breath go. They will say, oh no. Of course, friends and dear ones will become very sad, but those virtuous people, when they die, they will not make any fuss. What the poet meant here is that in this poem, poet is going to some other place, say like from England he was going to Italy and somewhere like that. So he's asking his beloved, that is to his wife and more, not to cry. See, don't cry like ordinary people when husband goes somewhere. You are not an ordinary lady. You are a great lady. You are my wife. So you are not supposed to cry. Because great people, when they pass away from earth, they go without making any noise. So let us melt and make no noise. No tears flood, no sighs tempest move. It were profane of our joys to tell the lighty our love. So he says that. So you understood, we are not ordinary people. So let us melt. He's asking, let us melt and make no noise. Don't make noise, okay? No tears flood. Again, you can see hyperbole, just like canonization. Don't cause flood with your tears, and don't cause a tempest with your sighs. It will be a profane to our love. If you cry, that will be a disgrace for your love. If you're crying like an ordinary woman, then it is a disgrace for your love. Now, moving of the earth brings harms and fears. Men reckon what it did and meant, but repetition of the spheres, though greater far, is innocent. So when earthquakes happen, men, they will become very of course they will become very scared. But what about sun, Jupiter, other celestial bodies revolve? They don't cause any, according to the poet, we are not that affected by the very movement of the celestial bodies such as sun, Jupiter, Venus, Mars and all. So when great things revolve or great things happen, they take place in a slow and a steady manner. They won't cause much fuss. Only those low profile people or those ordinary people will only make fuss and all. So you should not behave like them. Dull sublunary lovers love, whose solid sense cannot admit absence because it doth remove those things which is elemented in it. Dull sublunary lovers love. That means ordinary lovers, ordinary earthly lovers. They cannot admit when bodies move. Whose solid sense, actually, ordinary people, their love is based on senses, five senses. Touch, see, smell, then what? Taste, etc. So ordinary people whose love is based on senses, they cannot admit when the body is taken, when the physical is taken away from, bodies taken away from each other, because it doth remove those things which elemented it. See, if a person is loving another person for the physical aspects, once the physical aspects aspect is removed, of course, their love will diminish. Okay, their love will decrease. But those people, if their love is not based on physical aspects, even if the physical object is removed, it won't affect them. That should be your love. But we by a love so much refined that ourselves know what, that ourselves not what it is. Inter assured of the mind, careless eyes, lips and hands to miss. See, you and me are so much refined. We are not like ordinary people. We know each other's mind very well. We are so connected. We are so careless about the eyes, lips, and hands. We don't mind. Our two souls, therefore, which are one, though I must go, endure not yet a breach, but an expansion like gold to airy thinnest beat. Again, he says that. See, our two souls, therefore, which are one. We are not two, just like in canonization. There also, you might have seen, he says that me and my beloved are not two bodies, but we are one, just like Phoenix. Here also he says, we are not two, but we are one. Though I must go, endure not yet a breach, but an expansion, like gold to airy thinnest beats. See, then he says that, even though I'm going away from you, right now I'm going away from you. See, it's not a breach. It's not a break in relationship. Actually, what is going to happen is expansion of relationship. It is just like when gold is beaten, it will expand, isn't it? Gold is the most ductile and malleable element, isn't it? Metal, isn't it? Similarly, poet says that even though I'm going to some other place, I'm going away from you, don't take it as a break in relationship. Actually, our relationship is going to expand just like gold. You got it? Just like gold. Because gold, when beaten, it will not break. Gold will not break when it is beaten. It will only expand. So you can see the complex type of comparison. See this? Very intellectual comparison, isn't it? Ingenious comparison. That's why I've said, the themes are highly intellectualized, complex, argumentative and rational in approach. Have you understood? See the features. So when you write, if you're getting an annotation, don't simply translate the meaning. You have to spot features here and here. We have seen so and so features. Irony, pun, wit. Seeing canonization, that is an irony. What? We are candles, we are taper, yeah, we are fleas, etc. Wit. Okay. Now, if they are two, they are two. So, as stiff twin compass are two. Thy soul, the fixed food, makes no show to move, but doth if the other do. Again, the world famous comparison. So he says, if someone says we are two, then we are two. Okay, we are two. But we are just like the two legs of a compass. If someone says we are not one, then okay, then we are two. But we are just like the two legs of a compass. Thy soul, that means beloved's, is the fixed foot, which makes no show, which is fixed. And the rotating foot is the poet. You got it? So when you, if you want to draw a circle, if you want to draw a neat, flawless circle, then the fixed foot should, the foot that is at the center, it should be fixed, isn't it? It should not make any deviation from the center. If it is making any deviation from the center, will we be able to complete the circle? No, isn't it? Similarly, beloved is the fixed foot, and running foot or the rotating foot is the poet. So he says that we are fixed. We are two legs of a compass, but we are fixed at the top. We are united at the top. Wherever I go, I will come back to you. It doesn't matter where I go. I will always come back to you. After completing my job, after doing my job, I will always come back to you to reunite with you. Isn't it? After drawing the circle, we will put the legs together. Isn't it? And though it sit in the center, yet when the other far doth roam, it leans and hearkens after it and grows erect as that comes home. So he says that, see, if a wife is fiddle to her husband, if a wife is devoted to her husband, husband will always come back to her. If wife is not devoted or if she is infidel, of course, that will take him away from her. Since you are fixed, since you are devoted, lovable, don't worry, I will come back to you. We will be reunited again. Okay. So have you understood this poem? Hello?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Now the next poem. Oh, one more line. One more stanza. Such will thou be to me, who must like other food obliquely run. Thy firmness makes my circle jest and make me and where I begun. So here the poet says that it is your love, it is your fidelity, it is your devotion that make me come to you. Okay. So see, you can see something here. See, it doesn't matter even if I go behind some other woman, you should not go after anyone. If you are fiddle, if you are devoted, I will always come back to you. See, that's the how clever he is. Poor. Okay, next poem. So you have understood the very style of the poet, right? See how he deals the profane themes like love making, love, in a very spiritual, divine manner. So another feature of John Donne is he has a peculiar ability to deal any profane themes in spiritual or a divine manner. Okay, so that's the... Now rest of the poems, I'll be only discussing the first stanza and the themes, because if I'm discussing the entire poem, I won't get time. Flee. Again, another poem by John Donne. Mark but this flea, mark in this, how little that which thou deniest me is. It sucked me first and now suck thee. And in this flea our two bloods mingle be. Thou know that this cannot be said. Sin, no shame, no loss of maidenhead. Yet this enjoys before it woo and pampers well with one blood made of two. And this, alas, is more than we would do. So the flea is a sensual erotic poem. This is not spiritual, highly sensual erotic. The poem deals with love making, the theme of love making. Okay, so Anne Moore, she is a Protestant lady. Okay, so she is very coy, shy. She is not offering any love, I mean, love favors, I mean, physical favors to the poet. So poet is a bit angry with his beloved. So he's comparing the union, the physical union of poet and his beloved to that of a flea. Actually, this lady hasn't extended any physical favors to the poet. Okay, so mark but this flea. See, even though you haven't given me any physical pleasure, see, this flea has given me. In what way? Let us see. Mark about this flea. Mark in this. You look at this flea. How little that which thou deny me is. See, you have denied me physical pleasure. It sucked me first, but and now sucks thee. See, but this bee has done it for me. For us, not for me. For us. It sucked my blood first, and it sucked your blood. Now, the flea has mingled two bloods in it. That means the blood of the poet and the blood of the beloved. Okay, so flea is actually a marriage bed. So the metaphysical, can you see the metaphysical conceit over here? In this line, you can see the metaphysical conceit. Flea is the metaphysical conceit. And the flea conceit runs all throughout the poem. Flea is compared to the marriage bed, bower, chamber, a bed in which poet and beloved makes, in which they make love. Okay. In this flea, our two bloods mingle be, thou know that this cannot be said, a sin nor shame nor loss of maidenhead, yet this enjoys before it woo. Okay. Being a Protestant lady, she cannot offer those sexual favors to poet before marriage, because she doesn't want to bear that shame, that commit that sin. So anyway, you haven't committed any sin, even though you have denied this. This flea had made it happen. Pampered swell, yet this enjoys before it woo. Pampered swells with one blood made of two, and this, alas, is more than we should do. So the poet says that now we are not two, we are one. Why? Because we has mingled our blood. And in the next stanza, you can see that, anyway, it is not directly said, but poet is behaving as if beloved has killed the flea. Beloved has become very angry after hearing this. She might have killed the flea. Then poet is saying that, see, you have killed not a single creature, but you have killed flea, me and you. By killing the flea, you have committed a grave mistake, because you have taken the lives of three creatures, beloved, poet and flea. So that's the very summary of flea. Okay, very sensual poem, very interesting. Then Twickenham. Twickenham is a very funny poem. Twickenham Garden. So in this poem also, see, poet and his beloved has quarreled with each other, and she has declined. She has rejected his love favors. So he's very sad. So poet has written this poem sitting in the garden of his countess. I mean, his patroness, countess of Bedford. Okay, Bedford. Her name is Lucy. John Donne had another patroness named Lucy. She is the Countess of Bedford. Okay, so sitting in her garden, Twickenham, he has written this poem. That's why he has given the title Twickenham Garden. So in this poem, he has quarreled with his beloved, and he comes to the garden to get some solace, but he fails in it, because if you are sad, the entire thing, it doesn't matter if you're sitting in the middle of a festive surrounding or a festive occasion. If you're sad inside, everything around will be appearing gloomy. Okay, so blasted with sighs and surrounded with tears, hither I come to seek the spring, and at mine eyes and at my ears receive such balms as else cure everything. But O self prater, I do bring the spider love, which substantiate all, and can convert manna to God, and that this place may thoroughly be thought. true paradise I have serpent bought. So in this poem, after being rejected by his beloved, he comes to the garden, Twickenham garden, to get some solace. Okay. He thought the plants and trees in the garden will heal his wound. But at that time only he discovered, oh self-traitor, traitor, he calls himself the traitor. Why? Because he had made that place impure. How he had made impure or venomous? Because he had brought that spider love. What do you mean by spider love? We know that after spider and scorpion, all those things, after making love, they will kill the male part, isn't it? Male counterpart. So he says that because he has been rejected by his beloved. Now he is dejected. He is in a very sad mood. So he had brought that venomous love, one-sided, defeated love to the garden. So he is not able to enjoy the very beauty of the garden. That is why he says that he is a traitor. He has spoiled such a beautiful place with his sorrows. That means his love is now a spider love. His love is not real. It is a spider love because he has been rejected. And he says that that poison, his spider love. Gal means it's a poison. Okay. So I hope you know the meaning of manna. Manna is a heavenly bread given to the people who are hungry on earth. Similarly, this is a poison. One-sided love. One-sided love is a poison. Okay. That is very poisonous. It can convert any heavenly food into poison. Actually, our poet was a very happy guy, enthusiastic, high-spirited guy. But after being rejected by his beloved, he became so sad. He went to the garden to get some consolation. But he failed to get. And he identifies himself as a traitor. Why? Because he has brought one-sided love to the garden. And he's not able to enjoy the beauty of the garden. Wherever he looks, he can see only gloominess. Why? Because he is gloomy. So he says that his sorrow can convert any happiness to poison. That this place may thoroughly be thought true paradise I have set and brought. Even though garden is a paradise, my one-sided love is a serpent. So the one-sided serpent has been one-sided love is said to be is compared as a serpent. Please mark it. Okay. Then he says that in the next two stanza we can see that poet says asks other lovers to come and collect his tears. He is a fountain in the garden. You might have seen fountains in the garden. So here in this case, poet is the fountain in the garden, and the tears that is coming from his eyes can be collected in a vessel. And he's asking the other lovers to taste the tears. He's also asking them to taste the tears of their beloveds, lovers. If the taste of his tear and the taste of their beloveds are not same, then their lovers are fake. I repeat, poet is asking other lovers to come to the garden and to collect his tears in a bowl, in a vessel. And he's asking other lovers to drink, to taste his tears. And he's also asking them to taste the tears of their lovers. If the both tears if they don't taste alike, if they don't taste alike, then the tears of their lovers are fake. What he means here is that women are fake. Actually, tear is only their weapon. If they are crying, then that is only their weapon. If a woman cries, don't believe them. But in the third stanza, we can see that he's trying to reconcile with his lovers. I don't mean you. I'm just telling about other women who are fake. You are very much true. Even though you have denied me, you are very genuine. Your feelings are very true. Okay. See how this person has used that conceit of garden, spider love. Spider love is nothing. One-sided love. serpent, again, one-sided love. True paradise is the garden. There are so many metaphors, many metaphors in this. Okay, metaphor is the direct, I hope you know that, it's the direct comparison. Yeah. Now, the next poem, Good Morrow. Good Morrow is yet another wonderful poem. That means good tomorrow, good morrow. I wonder by my truth what thou and I did till we loved. We were not weaned till then, but sucked on country pleasure childishly, or snorted we in the seven sleepers then. It was so, but this all pleasure's fancy be. If ever any beauty I did see, which I desire and got, it was but a dream of thee. So in this poem, he says that he and his poet were sleeping until they were met. Until they met. They were sleeping just like biblical sleepers. I think you are familiar with seven biblical sleeper. Seven sleepers mentioned in the Bible. So seven children during the reign of some tyrant king. They were order. And I mean, those children were order. I mean, they were... they have been got the death sentence. So they came in a den and they sleep there for 187 years. After so many years, they wake up from their sleep and they go to the market and they were about to purchase something. When they exchanged the gold coin, the shopkeeper identified the coin and he became very surprised because it was believed to be in usage 200 years ago. Then only the seven sleepers, they understood that they were sleeping. They had been sleeping for 187 years. So just like that, so seven sleepers is the metaphysical conceit in this poem. You got it, seven sleeper. Okay, so just like the seven sleepers in the Bible, poet and his beloved were sleeping for many centuries until they met. Even though poet and his beloved have taken birth, lived a life, individual life till their youthful stage, they were, according to poet, they were simply sleeping just like a baby after sucking the milk of the mother. They were simply wasting their life. Their life become fruitful only after meeting each other. So in the coming stanza, we can see that poet says that so many people have many other fancies, like traveling around the world. Some wanted to discover new things, new places, just like Christopher Columbus. But they don't want to discuss any hi-fi things or travel around the world. They just want to explore each other. Again, sensual themes, physical themes. Okay, he says that, see, beloved and poet are two parts of the world, southern and northern hemisphere. We know that we have two hemispheres, isn't it? Northern and southern hemisphere. So here he compares himself and his beloved to southern and northern hemisphere. When they combine, it forms the complete earth. Similarly, they two are, if they until they see each other, they were incomplete. They were distinct poles. They were just like distinct poles. But once they fell in love, they became the northern and southern hemisphere combined to form a globe. They are now fused. Have you understood this poem, Good Morrow? Good Tomorrow. And the theme, you have two complicated conceits, two complicated metaphysical conceit in this poem. Seven sleepers, mentioned in Bible, and another one is southern and northern hemisphere. Beloved and poet are two hemisphere of the earth. Now, Ecstasy, yet another poem. Ecstasy has got, it's a pun, okay? It's like a pun. So, Ecstasy, normally the meaning is excited state. Another meaning is transubstantiate state, which means coming out of the body. After become, if you see, if you are in a euphoric state, if you are very happy, you will come out of your body. You will reach that in a blissful state. Okay. Similarly, poet and his beloved. They are enjoying, they are in a blissful state after getting consummated, after getting united. After their physical union, they are in a excited state, in a blissful state. According to John Donne, one can reach God in two ways. You can reach God in two ways, isn't it? Through religious ways, by praying God, being faithful to God, and by being faithful to your partner, isn't it? There are two ways, through worldly ways and through religious, spiritual ways, you can reach God. So this person has chosen the other way, that is being faithful to the partner by making love with his beloved. He has reached that transubstantiate state. He has come, his soul has come out of the body. Not only his soul, but also the soul of his beloved has come out of her body. They have fused together to form a new soul. New soul. Okay. So I told you ecstasy has got two meanings. The excited state. Of course, the poet and his beloved are very much excited after when they make love. Then another meaning is to come out of the body. Transubstantiate state, to enter a different world of happiness in a blissful state after love making. Now they are in a blissful state. So that is the pun used in the poem. Pun is another feature of metaphysical poetry. Now let us see. Where like a pillow on a bed, a pregnant bank swelled up to rest. The violet's reclining head sat be two. One another's best. So in this poem, let me tell you, using geographical and nature themes, he has discussed about physical love, sexual love. Okay, so where like a pillow on a bed, a pregnant bank swelled up to rest, violet reclining head sat we two on another's best. So poet and his beloved, they are sitting near a bank of a river, and the river bank is pregnant. A pregnant bank swelled up to rest. I mean that river is full of water, and you can see so many flowers by the bank of the river. That is why it is said that the river bank is pregnant, and you can see where like a pillow on a bed, a pregnant bank swelled up to rest. The willow, violet flower means. Actually, violet has a peculiarity that it produces flower through asexual reproduction. Asexual reproduction. Okay. Just like that. Just like a violet flower, we are sitting next to each other. Our hands were firmly cemented with a fast bump, which then did spring. Our eyes being twisted and did thread. Our eyes upon one double string. So in this poem, he says that they were sitting near the bank of a river, holding their hands tight, just like they were cemented. And they are so lost in each other. They are so lost. They are so fused in each other that they are so carefree about the rest of the world. Their eyes have been twisted. And their eyeballs, their eyes are just like beads on a thread. Okay. They are so connected. They cannot take eyes from each other. So engrafted our hands as yet was all mean to make us one, and pictured in our eyes to get was all our propagation. Again, the theme is getting repeated. They can see each other in one another's eye. So actually, after love making, they have entered to a different world. Previously, they had some follies. No one is perfect, isn't it? No man and no woman is perfect. Everyone will have their own follies, their own flaws. But after getting mingled, after reunion, after sexual reunion, they have mingled. They have the beloved soul and poet soul have come out of their body. Now they have fused like a violet flower. It has fused like a violet flower. And now the so-called new energy, the new soul is devoid of any flaws. Actually, if they have compensated each other's mistake. You got it? That is a very theme of ecstasy. Have you understood this poem, ecstasy? Ecstasy. Hello? Somebody over here? See, metaphysical poetry is not that difficult. When compared to other poems, metaphysical poetry is very easy, okay? You just need to read this poem once, only once. You can easily understand these poems. Because all these poems have similar themes. Love, lovemaking, religion, etc., etc. Batter My Heart, yet another beautiful poem by John Donne. Another poem, Batter My Heart, 3% God for you has yet, this is a religious poem, okay? Unlike other poem which are based on sexual love or love make or love, this poem is purely religious. This is a religious poem. Just a second. It's 2 minutes, 2 minutes. Batter My Heart, 3% God for you has yet but knock, breathe, shine, and seek to mend, that I may rise and stand over through me. And when you force to break, blow, burn, and make me new, I like an usurped town to another due, labor to admit you, but oh, to no end, reason your viceroy in me, should defend but captive and proves weak and untrue. So in this poem, he addresses God. Actually addresses God in Trinity form, Son, Holy Spirit, isn't it? Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. According to Christian philosophy or Christian ideology, God is in Trinity form, isn't it? Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. So he's invoking God in Trinity form, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. He's asking God to batter his, what do you mean by batter? I hope you know the meaning of batter. So just like that, he wants his heart to be molded anew, afresh. He wanted his God to form a batter by destroying his current heart, by destroying his current body heart. God wants to make a batter. Then out of that batter, God has to reshape into new, something new. So let me, has yet but knock, breathe, shine, and seek to mend, that I may rise and stand over through me. And when you force to break, blow, burn, and make new. So there are three comparisons. According to, as for this poem, there are three comparisons. He compares God to a ravisher, again God to a viceroy, again God to a pot maker. I repeat. He compares God to a ravisher, one who assaults woman. Okay, ravisher. Then second, he compares God to a pot maker, one who makes the pot. Then third one, he compares God to a viceroy of an army. So he says that he has been sung in the tank of sink. He has been immersed in the tank of sin. So he's asking God to break him, to blow him, to burn him, and to remold him into new. He wants to destroy his present state, and he wants to take birth again. So his comparison, I like an usurped town. He says that he has been usurped. He is comparing himself to a town which has been taken over by devil or Satan. So he's asking God to attack the town. Okay, just like a viceroy, please take after the rule of the town. I repeat, town is the beloved. Sorry, town is the poet. Town is the poet. And town has been captured. This city has been captured by the Satan. is an usurped town taken over by the Satan. So he's asking God to defeat the Satan and take over the rule of the town. Now he has been said as a viceroy of the army. Now second comparison is he compares himself to a woman, a woman who has been given in marriage against her wishes. He doesn't love the the poet doesn't love the person whom he was given in marriage. Okay, so he's asking the God to come and ravish him, so has to cancel the marriage so that he will get a divorce from his partner, so he can accept God as his partner. Second comparison, very complex comparison, he compares himself to that of a woman who has been given in marriage against her wishes. So he is asking God, God is her lover, God is the lover of the poet. So he's asking God to come and ravish me so that my marriage will get cancelled. I can marry you. So, okay, second comparison. Now, third comparison, he's a flawed vessel. He's a flawed vessel, a pot. The pot is not perfect. So he's asking God to break that pot and mold him again. He's a flawed vessel, so he's asking God. I hope you got the meaning of batter my heart. Is it clear? Batter my heart. Hello?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Now, came to my father. So it's a very sweet, small poem. Wilt thou forgive that sin where I begin? Which was
excuse
sin.
Excuse me. Excuse yeah, me, yeah. Ma'am. What about Nocturnal?
That next poem.
Okay, ma'am.
It's coming. Wilt thou forgive that sin where I begun, which was my sin though it were done? Wilt thou forgive that sin through which I run and do run still? Thou still I deplore when thou had not done, for I have more. So in this is also a religious poem, just like Batter My Heart, where he is asking God, can you forgive me for the mistake I have done? Actually, this mistake, I haven't started this mistake. My forerunners, my ancestors have started this. Wilt thou forgive that sin where I began? See, will you forgive me for the mistake which has created me? Actually, it is a reference to Adam and Eve in the paradise. Actually, after having that forbidden fruit, they committed the original sin. And we believe that human beings are the aftermath of that original sin, isn't it? So he's asking God, can you forgive me for the original sin committed by my forefathers, ancestors, which was my sin, though it were done before. Actually, it is my sin, even though it was done before. Will thou forgive that sin, thou which run, with which I run? See, is it possible for you, forgive me for the sin that I'm going through and that I'm committing? Do run still, thou still I do deplore. That means, see, not only the poet, entire world is repeating the sin committed by Adam and Eve. So is it possible for you to forgive me those mistakes? When thou had done, thou had not done, for I have more. Okay, see, let me tell you something. Actually, I have more mistake. I have done more mistakes. Is it possible for you to forgive me for all those mistakes I have done? At first, he started with the original sin committed by his great ancestors, Adam and Eve. Then he's asking, is it possible for you to forgive me for the mistake that I'm going to do, that I'm going through? Okay. So then in second and third stanza, you can see that, I have done many mistakes. For so many years I haven't done. See, you might have seen a drunkard. Sometimes a drunkard will drunk consecutively throughout a week, but for two or three weeks he won't drink. Similarly, poet has done some mistake for some time. After that, he has forced it, and he remains still. After a week or two, just like a pig, he will roll in that mistake. Sometime I have exploited myself in that mistake. So is it possible for you to forgive me for all those mistakes I have done? I know I have come, done a lot of mis- in third stanza you can see I have a sin of fear that when I have spun my last thread, I shall perish on the shore. Swear by thyself that at my death my thy son shall shine as he shines now. Yeah, so he's asking, I know a judgment day will be there, where I will be judged. So at that time, will you be there? Will you uplift me? Will you forgive all my mistakes? If you are there with me, I know you are there with me, so I have no fear. That is the very gist of this poem. Now, Saint, a nocturnal upon St. Lucy's day. So St. Lucy, let me tell you, St. Lucy is the goddess of cold and winter, desolation and despair. And St. Lucy's day is observed on December 13th. December 13th. And critics believe that he is lamenting the death of his patroness. Some critics believe that he is lamenting the death of his patroness, Lucy, Countess of Bedford. And some other critics believe that he is lamenting the death of his beloved, that is Anne Moore, his wife. After giving birth to 12 children, she died, okay? John Donne married Anne Moore, but after giving birth to 12 children, she died. So he is lamenting, some critics say that he is lamenting the death of his beloved. Anyway, let's see. It is the year's midnight and it is the days. Lucy, who scarce 7 hours herself unmasked, the sun is spent, and now this flask. And forth light squibs and no constant rays, the world whole sap is sung. So he says that it's the year's midnight. Let me tell you, December 13 is the at December 13, on December 13, sun will hardly shine for 7 hours. Okay, it will only shine for 7 hours. So he says that is the midnight of the year. It's the days, Lucy, who scares even 7 hours herself unmasked. Sun is spent, now his flax send forth light squibs, no constant rays, the world's whole sap is sung. So entire world is in darkness. You cannot see sun anymore. So that reason, entire world is in darkness. That means his beloved has gone. So he is in darkness. General balm of the hydroquil earth hath drunk, were wither has to the bed feet, like life is shrunk, death interrupt, yet all these seem to laugh compared with me, or who I am their epitaph. See, there are not only the poet, there are many other lovers who had been got away from their beloveds, but poet's condition is somewhat different. He had lost his beloved forever. Even though his love is not based on physical aspects, he had lost his beloved forever. Now he cannot find happiness in anything. What he has is nothingness. Wherever he looks, he can see nothingness everywhere. So he says that towards the end of the poem, he optimistically believes that he can reunite with her. He can reunite with her in the grave. That is a very summary of the poem, Nocturnal Upon St. Lucy. Here, poet compares sun to that of his beloved. Sun is the beloved. Okay. On St. Lucy's day, sun will not shine more than 7 hours. Okay. So that day is believed to be the midnight of the year. 13th December is believed to be the midnight of the year. So he believes that the day which he had lost the particular person is the midnight of the year, because that particular day is sang in darkness. Sang in darkness. Because poet is now in darkness. In the absence of his beloved, he is in darkness. When the rest of the world are enjoying, when the rest of the lovers are enjoying with the beloveds, even though they have some quarrels, some silly quarrels among them, it is sure that they will get reunited with their lovers. But in the case of poet, it is impossible. He cannot find happiness in anything. Wherever he looks, he can see dismay. So he anticipates that someday he will be reunited with his wife. That is the very summary or gist of the poem, Nocturnal Upon St. Lucy's Day. So sun is beloved is compared to the sun. Now, the next metaphysical poet is Andrew Marvell, an English metaphysical poet, satirist, political writer, Latin secretary of John Milton. Let me tell you something. This person has lived through the reign of James Fiske, then Charles Fiske, then Oliver Cromwell, and he was also an opportunist. Okay, you can see poems praising Charles Fiske and Oliver Cromwell. Okay, yeah, he has worked as a tutor to many Nobel awards. Then he's a political writer. Once again, the features of Marvell's poetry: stretched metaphors, extended metaphors, logical and passionate arguments, syllogistic style. There is a clarity and control in his verse, serious and secular, sincere approach, flexible rhythms, delicate melody, fantastic conceit. So these are the common features of Andrew Marvell's poetry. I know what a syllogistic, I hope you know that. After, yeah, it's more or less like a mathematical approach. His poems are more or less like a mathematical approach. So let's see his poems. Let me check the time, okay. It's 11:30. So, to his coy mistress, in this poem, he's addressing his beloved. Same theme, who has declined to extend sexual favor to the lover. This is a sensual poem. Had we but world enough time, and this coyness lady were no crime, we would sit down and think which way to walk and pass our long love's day. Though the Indian Ganges side, thou should ruby's fine, and I by tide of humber would complain. I would love you 10 years before the flood, and you should, if you please, refuse till the conversion of Jews. My vegetable love should grow faster than empires and more slow. So in this poem, he's persuading his beloved to extend him, to give him sexual favors. Being a Protestant lady, just like Anne Moore, being a Protestant lady, she is not ready to extend sexual favors to the Andrew Marvell. So he's asking, see, had we but world enough time? See, do we have enough time and space on this earth? If we have enough space and time on this earth, your shyness weren't a crime. But unfortunately, we don't have enough time and space on earth. We are not immortals. We are mortals. We will die, isn't it? See, if we had enough time, we would have walked. You could have walked by the side of Indian River Ganga, and I could have walked by the side of Humber, where I could sit and complain about my unreciprocated love. If we had enough time, I would have loved you. If we were immortals, if we were just like God and goddesses, then I would have loved you before the flood. You could have keep on rejecting me until the entire Jews of the world converted to Christianity. Okay. He says that, actually he's telling his beloved that we are not immortals. We are human beings. We are mortals. For that reason, you should not keep on declining my proposal. You have to accept my offer. See, if we are immortals, then you could have keep on rejecting me. I would have accepted it. I would have complained about my unreciprocated love sitting on the side by the bank of River Humber. And my love for you only grow like a vegetable. My love for you is like a vegetable. What is the peculiarity of vegetable? Unlike human being, after attaining a certain age, we will cease the growth. Isn't it? Our growth will be ceased. But vegetables or trees, plants, they will grow until they die. So my love is vegetable love. It will grow. It will grow faster than an empire. And 100 years should go to price thine eyes, and on thy forehead gaze 200 to adore each breast. If we had enough time, I would have praised your eyes 100 years. I would have praised your forehead to 200 years. Then I will again give 200 years to adore your breast. Similarly, I will take 30,000 years to praise rest of your body parts. If we were immortal, if we had enough time and space, I would have loved you in a different way. But let me tell you, at an age, at least to every part, and the, at last age should show your heart. And for lady, you deserve the state, and nor would I love at lower rate. See, if we, I had enough time, if we had enough time, I would have given time to love your different body parts. I would have given enough time to love your different body parts, and at last, you have to show me your heart. Lady, you for sure you deserve this praise. Unfortunately, I don't have enough time. But at my back, I can. I always hear time's winged chariot hurrying near, and yonder all before us lie. Desert, vast eternity, thy beauty shall no more be found, nor in thy marble wall shall sound. My echoing song then worms shall try that long-preserved virginity, and your quaint honor turn to dust, and into ashes all my lust. It says that time is running very fast. Actually, it is running, it is going like a chariot with wings. So, let me tell you, now you are very conscious about your virginity, you're preserving it like anything. After some years, you will die. All your beauty, and your beauty will not be found in the graveyard. Of course, when you are placed in the graveyard, we cannot make love. We cannot hug. Isn't it? All your so preserved virginity and all your beauty will be relished by the worms. Your long preserved virginity will be enjoyed by the worms, and all my love for you will turn into ashes. So he's asking his beloved, we don't have enough time. Please give me the pleasure that I'm looking from you. Grave is a fine and a private place. None, I think, do their embrace. He's asking. He's again telling, see, graveyard is a fine and a private place, I know, but no one is going to hug you, my dear. If you want me to hug you, then this is the perfect time. Come to me. But now, therefore, while the youthful hue sits on thy skin like a morning dew, now you are very young, your skin is very soft, just like a morning dew, which is transpiring. Every inch of your skin is waiting for something. Actually, it is every pore with instant fires. Now let us sport us while we may, and now like amorous bird of prey, rather at once our time devote, that languish in his slow chap power, let us roll all our strength and all our sweetness up into one bowl. So he's asking, this is the perfect time, since we both are young, all our body, inch to inch, actually we are glowing with, we are glowing in fire. So this is the right time to make love. Let us roll into a single ball. Again, sexual connotations. Let us roll into a single ball and tear our pleasure with a rough stripe through iron gates of life. Let's shoot. After forming a ball, let's shoot into the iron gate of life. So he's asking, it is not possible to make the sun still, isn't it? It is not possible for us to make the time still, but we can make him run fast. Because if we are getting engaged in the thing that we love, of course, time will pass very soon. So he's asking his beloved to come and make love with him. That is the very theme of to his coy mistress. And the theme is carpe diem. Let me tell you, to seize the day. Seize the day, carpe diem is the theme of this poem. I hope you know that Latin phrase, carpe diem. Qua yes, minima credula postero. Yes, that means seize the day. Seize the day, trusting the least possibility of tomorrow. Okay. Now I'm moving on to the next poem, Garden. See, in the previous poem, he says that beloved is everything so beautiful, so and so. But this is a misogynistic poem in which he says that beauty of woman is nothing when compared to beauty of the garden. Let's see. How vainly men dance of amaze to win the palm, the oak or base, and their uncertain labors see crowned from some single herb or tree, whose short and narrow verse shade does prudently their toils upbraid, while all flowers and all trees do close to weave the garland of repose. So in this poem, he's asking how vainly men are going after palm, oak, and base. To win palm, oak, and base. Because men are busy gaining wealth, victory, honor, and all. See, actually, those things, they are laboring from, they are toiling, they're working hard from morn till evening. Those are very worthless. Actually, what they are getting after working from morning till evening, or after doing something a labor. Hmm? What they're getting, palm or can bay. They had nothing to do with it. So he's asking those people who are running after women, success and money, to come and enjoy the solace or the consolation of the shelter offered by the garden. Fair quiet have I found thee here. So fair quiet is here. Quietness in the garden that has been personified as a beautiful woman. Personification, you can see personification. He says that fair quiet have I found thee here, and innocence thy sister dear. That means innocence and quietness are two qualities which you can only see in the garden or in the nature. Actually, quietness and innocence have been personified here as sisters. Mistaken long has sought you then in the busy company of men, you sacred plants. If here below, only among the plants will grow. So he says that this person has been searching for two beautiful ladies, quietness and innocence, in the busy company of men, city men. But he failed to find them there. At last, he failed them in this garden. No white, no red was ever seen so amorous at this lovely green. Fond lovers' cruelty has their flame cut in these trees in the mistress' name. Little, alas, they know or hear how far these beauties hers exceed. Okay, so he says that no white, no red was ever seen. That is again a reference to earthly women. He says that painted cheeks and rose, painted cheeks and lips. Reference to women. No woman is as beautiful as a lovely green tree or lovely green plants and trees in the garden. But these cruel lovers, you might have seen all those lovers who are encircling the tree, who are busy carving their names on the tree. So he's saying how cruel they are. See, if I were in their place, then I would have carved the tree only for writing the name of the tree. I am not that stupid enough to write the name of my beloved on the bark of the tree. If I ever cut a tree, if I ever carve a tree, then it will be only for writing the name of that tree. You got it? When we have run our passion's heat, love hither makes this best tree. The gods that moral beauty chase still in the tree did end their race. So he's in this stanza, he says that, see, in Greek mythology, in Roman mythology, you might have seen the myth of trees. I mean, whoever had run after love, all their chases have ended in trees, because Apollo had once chased a beautiful earthly woman, Daphne, but she has been turned to a laurel tree. Then Pan, god of shepherd, once he chased string, then she had been turned into a reed, out of which he made a flute. So all those love, all those chase behind, all those chase after love had ended in trees. Then in the next stanza, he says that he comes to the garden again, and he says that as he walks through the garden, his head touched the vines, grapes. If he makes a slight attempt, he can relish the nectar of the grapes. Then he was stumbled by the tendril of a melon, and he was fallen. When he was fallen, his heart came out of his body just like a bird. Then he enters into a transubstantiated state, as John Donne mentioned in Ecstasy. While he was in the garden, when he was in the garden only, his soul came out of his body. In John Donne's case, when he united with his wife, he entered that transubstantiate state. Here, Andrew Marvell entered the transubstantiate state when he sat in the garden. So he says that garden is a blissful blissful place. It is very beautiful than any other earthly woman. So his heart came out like a bird. Now sitting on a branch of a tree, which is combing his silver wings, preparing for a flight. So his heart is also just like a bird, is looking for a greater existence. Now, so again, he says that you can see the misogynistic lines in the stanza. Such was their happy garden state while man there walked without a mate. He says that, see, in previous stanza, he was in the previous poem to his coy mistress, he was actually requesting, pleading to his beloved, extend me, give me some sexual favors. But in this stanza, he was saying, see, man was in a very blissful state when he was alone in the garden. When he was alone in the Eden garden, he was very happy. See, this wild men there walk without a mate after a place so pure. What other help could yet be meet? But it was beyond a mortal share to wander solitary there. To paradise it were in want to live in the paradise alone. So he says that it was to live in the paradise alone. It was like some double paradise. Okay. At first, Adam was...
Hello?
Here. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Hello?
Yeah, yeah. Can you hear me? Yeah, hello, ma'am.
Ah, yeah. My group didn't carry it anymore. Hello, kekamo?
Good
morning, Prima, ma'am.
Ah, yeah, good morning, good morning. Good morning, everybody. Actually, I'm entering your class for the first time. Krishna, you can continue with the official group ask them to change the icon as MEG 2020 July. MEG 2020 July. Okay. Now, I think we will have a Google Meet with regard to their queries about assignment submission, term and examination, etc. Assignment submission, at present, last date is 31st March, but it may be postponed. I think so, because no news have been arrived about the exam form submission and all. So there may be a change in the last date for assignment submission. I think so. Anyway, Krishna, you can tell them. And moreover, you can tell them to hold a Google Meet any day in the evening. I don't know whether Krishna knows that I fell down in the ground and my bones is broken, actually, and I'm on rest for the last 12 days.
Oh, ma'am.
Some problem with the leg also, and hand, right hand also. One of the bones is broken. Okay. So that is why I cannot do much communication with you and you all. Okay. I think the students can arrange a Google Meet so that we can discuss everything. I am not stealing your time in the class. So ask them, maybe most probably somewhere on Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, other subjects paper, they have already arranged a Google Meet. And most probably Friday, Thursday evening, if they are free, they can arrange by night, 8 p.m. or so, so that they can clear all the doubts. And you also be there, you also be a member of the group. And Anita is also a member, and one or two students can be the admins, same group, so that they can pass the important messages to us, and we can give the correct reply. Okay, that will be better. So you can pass the information to them and ask them to post the link that they, when they get a link of the class, ask them to post in the group also, because there may be somebody who did not get the link like that, maybe due to some problem, technical problem. So once the link is put in the posted in the group, everybody can enter. That will be better also from next class onwards. Okay. I'm not stealing your time.
പ്രത്യേകിച്ച് ഒന്നുമില്ല മാം, അവർക്ക് ഇപ്പൊ തന്നെ പഠിച്ചു പോകണം എന്ന് ഞാൻ എല്ലാവരോടും പറയുന്നുള്ളൂ. പരീക്ഷയുടെ തലേദിവസം വരെ കൊണ്ടുവെക്കുന്നില്ല എന്ന് പറയുന്നുള്ളൂ ഞാൻ എല്ലാവരോടും.
ഓക്കെ ഓക്കെ. അസൈൻമെന്റ് അസൈൻമെന്റ് ഐ തിങ്ക് എല്ലാ അസൈൻമെന്റ്സും ക്ലാസ്സിൽ ഡിസ്കസ് ചെയ്തിട്ടുണ്ടെന്ന് തോന്നുന്നു. ഓക്കെ ക്വസ്റ്റ്യൻസ് അസൈൻമെന്റ് ഗൈഡ് ലൈൻസ് ഞാൻ വേണമെങ്കിൽ ഗ്രൂപ്പിൽ പോസ്റ്റ് ചെയ്യുകയും ചെയ്യാം. ഗൈഡ് ലൈൻസ് ഗൂഗിൾ മീറ്റ് വെക്കുകയാണെങ്കിൽ അന്ന് കംപ്ലീറ്റ് ഗൈഡ് ലൈൻസ് പറഞ്ഞു കൊടുക്കാം, ഹൗ ടു റൈറ്റ് ദ ഫൈനൽ അസൈൻമെന്റ്സ് എക്സെട്ര ആൻഡ് ഹൗ ടു സബ്മിറ്റ് ഓൾ ദീസ് തിങ്സ് വി ക്യാൻ ഡിസ്കസ് ഐ തിങ്ക്. അപ്പൊ അവരോടൊന്ന് പറയുക, കാരണം എന്നെ എന്നെ മനസ്സിലായെന്ന് തോന്നുന്നു എല്ലാവർക്കും. My dear learners, I am Dr. Prema, the coordinator of
yes, SC 1400.
Okay. 1400 എടുത്ത സ്റ്റുഡൻസ് മാത്രമാണോ ഈ ഗ്രൂപ്പ് എന്ന് എനിക്ക് അറിഞ്ഞുകൂടാ. ഇറ്റ് ഇസ് ബെറ്റർ ടു ഹാവ് ദാറ്റ് പെർട്ടിക്കുലർ ഗ്രൂപ്പ് ഒരെണ്ണം. എന്തായാലും 1400 പല മെസ്സേജസും ചിലപ്പോൾ അവർക്ക് മാത്രമായിരിക്കും. സോ അതേഴ്സ് മേ മിസ്അണ്ടർസ്റ്റാൻഡ് ദാറ്റ് ഇസ് ടു ദിസ് ഗ്രൂപ്പ് ഓൾസോ. അപ്പൊ അത് 1400 മാത്രം ഒരു ഗ്രൂപ്പ് ഉണ്ടാക്കുക. ആൻഡ് യു ക്യാൻ ഹാവ് അനദർ ഗ്രൂപ്പ് ഇഫ് സംബഡി വാണ്ട്സ് ടു ബി ഇൻ ദ ഗ്രൂപ്പ്. Another group can be formed. That will be better. And this will be the official group. Okay. One or two students can call me. Either in the evening or so. So that when to arrange a Google Meet and all. Okay. Krishna. അത്രയും പേര് ഉണ്ടെങ്കിൽ ബാക്കിയുള്ളവർക്ക് എന്നാ വെച്ചാൽ ചെയ്യട്ടെ. ഐ തിങ്ക് സ്റ്റുഡൻസിന്റെ ടോട്ടൽ നമ്പർ കുറച്ച് കൂടുതലാണെന്ന് തോന്നുന്നു, പക്ഷെ ക്ലാസ്സിൽ അത്രയും കാണുന്നില്ല അല്ലേ. അതെ അതെ, എനിക്കൊന്ന് ബാക്കിയുള്ളവർക്ക് റെക്കോർഡ് വീഡിയോ കൊടുക്കും എന്നാണ് പറഞ്ഞിരിക്കുന്നത് RC-ന്ന്. അപ്പൊ റെക്കോർഡ് സെയിം തിങ് അപ്പൊ അതുകൊണ്ട് സം പീപ്പിൾ മേ പ്രിഫർ ദാറ്റ് റെക്കോർഡഡ് വീഡിയോ മതി എന്ന് വിചാരിക്കുന്നുണ്ടാവും. ഓക്കെ, അത് കുഴപ്പമില്ല. നമുക്കിപ്പോ ഒരു ക്ലാസ്സിൽ നേരിട്ട് ഇന്ററാക്ട് ചെയ്യണം എന്നുള്ളവർ മാത്രം വന്നാൽ മതി, ബാക്കിയുള്ളവർക്ക്. പക്ഷെ ഇന്ററാക്ട് ചെയ്യുന്നതിന്റെ ഒരു ഗുണമുണ്ട്, ദാറ്റ് സ്റ്റുഡൻസ് ഷുഡ് അണ്ടർസ്റ്റാൻഡ്. നേരിട്ടുള്ള ക്ലാസ് അറ്റൻഡ് ചെയ്യുന്നു മറ്റൊന്നും തമ്മിൽ. ഓക്കെ, കൃഷ്ണയ്ക്ക് എന്തെങ്കിലും ഉണ്ടോ പറയാൻ? എന്തെങ്കിലും ഉണ്ടോ?
ഇല്ല മാം.
ഓക്കെ, വൈകുന്നേരം ട്രെയിനിന്ന് വിളിച്ചാ മതി. ഓക്കെ, അതെ. അവരുടെ ഗ്രൂപ്പിന്റെ പേരില് ഒന്ന് 2020 July എന്നും കൂടി ചേർക്കാൻ പറയണേ, അല്ലെങ്കിൽ എനിക്ക് കൺഫ്യൂഷൻ ആവും ഏത് ഗ്രൂപ്പാണെന്നുള്ളത്. എൻഡിജിന്ന് മാത്രമേ ഇവര് ഇട്ടിട്ടുള്ളൂ. 2020 അഡ്മിഷൻ ഒന്നും കൂടി ഇട്ടിട്ടില്ലെങ്കിൽ എനിക്കത് പഴയതാണോ
പുതിയതാണോ?
2020 July എം ഇ ജി. ഓക്കെ, ഇഗ്നോ ഒന്നും വേണമെന്നില്ല. ഇഗ്നോ വയ്ക്കുന്നുണ്ടെങ്കിൽ വെച്ചോട്ടെ, കലൂറൊന്നും വേണമെന്നില്ല. ശരിക്കും 2020 July, ദാറ്റ് ഇസ് എം ഇ ജി 2020 July. ഈ മൂന്ന് വേർഡ്സ് അവിടെ എന്തായാലും ഉണ്ടായിരിക്കണം. ഓക്കെ ഓക്കെ, അപ്പൊ ശരി. ഓക്കെ, ലേണേഴ്സ് അവർക്ക് എന്തെങ്കിലും ചോദിക്കാനുണ്ടോ? എന്തെങ്കിലും അത്യാവശ്യം?
ഞാൻ ക്രിസ്റ്റീനാണ്. ഞാൻ ഗ്രൂപ്പ് എന്ന് ഉദ്ദേശിക്കുന്നത് വാട്സ്ആപ്പ് ഗ്രൂപ്പ് ആണോ?
അതെ അതെ, വാട്സ്ആപ്പ് ഗ്രൂപ്പ്.
അതിൽ ഞാൻ ആഡ് ചെയ്ത്, ഞാനില്ലല്ലോ, എല്ലാ ഗ്രൂപ്പില്ല.
അത് നിങ്ങളിപ്പോ ഈ ഒരു ഗ്രൂപ്പ്, ഇന്നത്തെ ഇന്നിപ്പോ ഒരു ഗ്രൂപ്പ് ഉണ്ടല്ലോ, ഒരു MEG എന്ന് പറഞ്ഞൊരു ഗ്രൂപ്പ് ഉണ്ട്, ഒഫീഷ്യൽ ഗ്രൂപ്പ്. രണ്ട് ഗ്രൂപ്പ് ഉണ്ടെന്നാ എനിക്ക് തോന്നുന്നത്. ഒന്നൊരു ഒഫീഷ്യൽ ഗ്രൂപ്പ് ഉണ്ട്,
വാട്സാപ്പിലില്ല.
അല്ല, വാട്സാപ്പിൽ ഇല്ലാത്തത് നിങ്ങള് എൻട്രി ചെയ്യാത്തോണ്ടാണ്. അതില് ക്ലാസ്സിൽ തന്നെ ഗ്രൂപ്പ് അഡ്മിൻ ആരാന്ന് ചോദിച്ചിട്ട് അതില് എൻട്രി ചെയ്യണം. ഹലോ,
ഹലോ, വേറെ രണ്ട് സബ്ജക്ട്സിലും ക്ലാസ് ഉണ്ടാവോ?
ഏത് ക്ലാസ് ഉണ്ടാവോ എന്ന് ചോദിച്ചാ ക്ലാസ് തരണമല്ലോ.
അല്ല, ഞാന് സ്റ്റഡി സെന്റർ ആണ് കോർഡിനേറ്റ് ചെയ്യാതെ ഇവിടുന്ന് തന്നെ വരും. ഇവിടുന്നാണെങ്കിൽ നന്നായിരുന്നു, നല്ല ക്ലാസ്
വരുന്ന. കൊച്ചി സ്റ്റഡി സെന്റർ ആണ് ഇത് ഓർഗനൈസ് ചെയ്യുന്നത്. RC വഴിയാ പോണതെങ്കിലും ഇറ്റ് ഇസ് അറേഞ്ച്ഡ് ബൈ സ്റ്റഡി സെന്റർ കൊച്ചി. ഞങ്ങളാണ് ഓർഗനൈസ് ചെയ്യുന്നത് കേട്ടോ. അപ്പൊ രണ്ട് മറ്റു രണ്ട് പേപ്പറിനും ഇത് കഴിഞ്ഞു കഴിഞ്ഞാൽ ഉടനെ അടുത്ത രണ്ട് പേപ്പറിനും ഉണ്ടാവും.
ഒരു കാര്യം കൂടെ ചോദിച്ചോട്ടെ, ഞാൻ മാഡത്തെ നേരത്തെ വിളിച്ചിരുന്നു, നമ്മുടെ റെക്കോർഡഡ് ക്ലാസ് ഒക്കെ അവൈലബിൾ ആയോ? കാരണം എനിക്ക് ലിങ്ക് വരാത്ത ഒരു പ്രശ്നം ഉണ്ടായിരുന്നു. പിന്നെ എന്താണ് എനിക്ക് ലിങ്ക് അയച്ചു തന്നത്?
എനിക്ക് തോന്നുന്നത് അടുത്ത് തന്നെ ആവുന്നാണ്. ഞാനൊന്ന് വീണിട്ട് കയ്യ് എല്ല് പൊട്ടിയിരിക്കുകയാണ്, റെസ്റ്റിലാണ്. റെസ്റ്റ് ആണ്. അപ്പൊ എനിക്ക് നേരിട്ട് ഓഫീസിൽ പോയിട്ട് പോകുന്നില്ല ഞാനിപ്പോ. പേപ്പേഴ്സ് ഒക്കെ ഇങ്ങോട്ട് കൊണ്ടുവരാം സൈൻ ചെയ്യാനുള്ളതൊക്കെ. അപ്പം ഞാനൊന്ന് എന്തായാലും റീജിയണൽ ഡയറക്ടറോട് ഞാൻ പറഞ്ഞിട്ടുണ്ട്. അപ്പൊ എന്നോട് പറഞ്ഞത് പെട്ടെന്ന് അവൈലബിൾ ആക്കും എന്നാണ് പറഞ്ഞത്. അത് അവൈലബിൾ ആയി കഴിഞ്ഞാൽ ഉടനെ തന്നെ നിങ്ങൾക്ക് ഞാൻ നിങ്ങളെ ഗ്രൂപ്പിൽ ഇട്ടേക്കാം മെസ്സേജ് കേട്ടോ. അപ്പൊ ഒന്ന് അതിന്റെ ലിങ്കിൽ പോയി നോക്കിയാ മതി.
ഈ വാട്സ്ആപ്പ് ഗ്രൂപ്പിന്റെ അഡ്മിൻ ആരെങ്കിലും ഇപ്പൊ ഈ ക്ലാസ്സിൽ ഉണ്ടെങ്കിൽ നമ്മളുടെ കമന്റ് സെക്ഷനിൽ ഒന്ന് അതിന്റെ ലിങ്ക് ഇടുവാണെങ്കിൽ
ആയിക്കോട്ടെ. ആരെങ്കിലും ഒരാൾ ഒന്നോ രണ്ടോ പേര് അതിൽ അഡ്മിൻ ആയിക്കോളാൻ പറയൂ. ആരെങ്കിലും നല്ല റെസ്പോൺസിബിൾ ആയിട്ടുള്ള ഒന്നോ രണ്ടോ സ്റ്റുഡൻസ് കേട്ടോ. അപ്പൊ നിങ്ങളുടെ ക്വരീസ് ഒക്കെ വേണമെങ്കിൽ ത്രൂ അഡ്മിൻ നിങ്ങൾക്ക് അതിനകത്ത് പോസ്റ്റ് ചെയ്യാം. പിന്നെ ഇതാ ഞാൻ പറഞ്ഞത്, നമുക്ക് വിൽ ഹാവ് എ ഡിസ്പ്. എല്ലാ ബാച്ച് എല്ലാ പ്രോഗ്രാമുകാരും ഞങ്ങളൊരു ഗൂഗിൾ മീറ്റ് നടത്തി. അപ്പൊ അവരുടെ ഡൗട്ട്സ് ഒക്കെ ക്ലിയർ ചെയ്യാൻ വേണ്ടിട്ട്. എം ഇ ജി മാത്രം നമ്മളിപ്പോ എല്ലാ ക്ലാസ് ഇപ്പൊ തുടങ്ങിയല്ലേ ഉള്ളു, അതുകൊണ്ടാണ്. അത് ഗ്രൂപ്പ് അഡ്മിൻ, ഗ്രൂപ്പ് അഡ്മിൻ ഷുഡ് ബി ഫ്രം ആർ സി കൊച്ച് 140000. അത്രേ ഉള്ളൂ. കാരണം പല ക്വറീസും എനിക്ക് മറ്റു കോർഡിനേറ്റേഴ്സ്, മറ്റ് സ്റ്റഡി സെന്ററിലുള്ളവരുടെ ക്വറീസ് എനിക്ക് അധികം പറയാൻ പറ്റില്ല. കാരണം ദേ വിൽ ബി ഹാവിങ് ദയർ ഓൺ വർക്ക് സ്റ്റൈൽ. അപ്പൊ ഞാൻ ഐ വോണ്ട് ഇന്റർഫിയർ ഇൻ ദയർ അഫയേഴ്സ്. ക്ലാസ്സിന്റെ കാര്യം മാത്രമേ എല്ലാവർക്കും കോമൺ ആയിട്ട് പറയും, ബാക്കിയുള്ളതെല്ലാം നമ്മള് ഈ സ്റ്റഡി സെന്ററിന്റെ കാര്യം മാത്രമേ ഞാൻ കൂടുതൽ സ്പെസിഫൈ ചെയ്യുള്ളൂ. കേട്ടോ. And Anita is also my friend. We were colleagues for so many years together. Okay.
Ma'am, ഞാൻ രണ്ടു ദിവസം ക്ലാസ് എനിക്ക് കിട്ടില്ല. അപ്പോ അസൈൻമെന്റും ടോപ്പിക്കും കാര്യങ്ങളും ഒന്നും എനിക്ക് കൃത്യമായിട്ട് അറിയില്ല. അപ്പൊ ഗ്രൂപ്പിൽ അതൊന്ന് ഇടാണെങ്കിൽ നല്ലതാണ്.
അല്ല, ഗ്രൂപ്പിൽ ഇടുക എന്ന് പറയുമ്പോഴും എപ്പോഴും അതൊരു വൺ സൈഡഡ് ആയിരിക്കും. അതാണ്, അതാ ഞാൻ പറഞ്ഞത്. നിങ്ങളൊരു ഒരു ഗൂഗിൾ മീറ്റ് വെച്ചിട്ട് എല്ലാവരും അതിനകത്ത് വരികയാണെങ്കിൽ നമുക്ക് ഡിസ്കസ് ചെയ്യാം. ഇപ്പൊ അസൈൻമെന്റ് ഇനിയിപ്പോ വെക്കാനുള്ളത് 2020 ജൂലൈയിലെ അസൈൻമെന്റ്സ് ആണ് എഴുതേണ്ടത്. 2020 ജൂലൈ. അപ്പൊ സൈറ്റിൽ നോക്കുക അസൈൻമെന്റ് ക്വസ്റ്റ്യൻസ് കേട്ടോ.
അത് സൈറ്റ് എനിക്ക് കൃത്യമായിട്ട് അറിയില്ല, അതാണ് പ്രശ്നം.
അതെന്താ നോക്കാനോ, പഠിക്കണ്ടേ? ഇങ്ങനെയുള്ള വെബ്സൈറ്റിൽ പോവാ. പിന്നെ അതിനകത്ത് സ്റ്റുഡന്റ് സപ്പോർട്ട് സർവീസസ് അല്ലെങ്കിൽ സ്റ്റുഡന്റ് സോൺ ഉണ്ട്. സ്റ്റുഡന്റ് സോണിനകത്ത് അസൈൻമെന്റ്സ് എന്ന് പറഞ്ഞിട്ട് ഒരു ലെഫ്റ്റ് ഹാൻഡിൽ കുറെ ഐറ്റംസ് കൊടുത്തിട്ടുണ്ട്. അതിനകത്ത് അസൈൻമെന്റ്സ് എന്ന് കാണാം. അതിൻ്റെ ഒന്ന് അസൈൻമെന്റ് സബ്മിഷൻ ആണ്, മറ്റേത് അസൈൻമെന്റ് ക്വസ്റ്റ്യൻസ് ആണ്. നിങ്ങളെ ഗ്രൂപ്പിൽ തന്നെ ആരെങ്കിലും അസൈൻമെന്റ് ക്വസ്റ്റ്യൻസ് ഡൗൺലോഡ് ചെയ്തിട്ട് അതിൽ ഇടാൻ പറയൂ. അതും മതിയല്ലോ, എല്ലാ ക്ലാസ്സുകാരും അങ്ങനെ ചെയ്യുന്ന. എല്ലാവരും പോയിട്ട് എടുക്കേണ്ട ആവശ്യമില്ല. ആരെങ്കിലും അത് എടുത്തവർ, ഓൾറെഡി എടുത്തവരുണ്ടാവുമല്ലോ, അവരോട് ഗ്രൂപ്പിൽ ഇടാൻ പറയാം. 2020 ജൂലൈ സെഷൻ, അതാണ് നിങ്ങളിപ്പോ എടുക്കേണ്ടത്. പിന്നെ സബ്മിഷൻ ഐതർ സ്റ്റഡി സെന്ററിലാണ് സബ്മിറ്റ് ചെയ്യേണ്ടത് എല്ലാവരും കേട്ടോ. എല്ലാവരും അവരവരുടെ സ്റ്റഡി സെന്ററിലാണ്. ഇപ്പൊ കേരളോർമ്മയാണെങ്കിൽ കേരളോർമ്മയിൽ കൊടുക്കണം, സി എം എസ് ആണെങ്കിൽ സി എം എസിൽ കൊടുക്കണം, ഇവിടെ കലൂരാണെങ്കിൽ കലൂർ കൊണ്ടുവരണം, അല്ലെങ്കിൽ നിങ്ങൾ യു കെൻ സെൻഡ് ബൈ പോസ്റ്റ്. രണ്ടായാലും ടു ദ സ്റ്റഡി സെന്റർ. ഓക്കെ ഓക്കെ, ഞാൻ കൃഷ്ണയുടെ സമയം കളയുന്നില്ല. ഓക്കെ കൃഷ്ണ, നമുക്ക് ബാക്കിയുള്ളത് പിന്നെ സംസാരിക്കാം. ഓക്കെ ഓക്കെ കൃഷ്ണ, താങ്ക് യു, ഞാൻ പിന്നെ വിളിക്കാം. ഓക്കെ ഓക്കെ.
ഹലോ
Yes, ma'am.
So in this stanza, see, I told you this in previous stanza, he was pleading, in the previous poem, he was pleading to his beloved to give him some sexual favors. But in this stanza, we can see that misogynistic attitude of the poet. Okay. So he says that when Adam was alone in the Eden garden, he was enjoying double paradise. Without the company of Eve, actually God has first created Adam, then only he has created Eve, right? Until the creation of Eve, Adam was having double paradise, isn't it? In the company of plants and trees. See how shrewd he is. How well the skillful gardener drew of flowers and herbs this dial knew, where from above the milder sun doth through a fragrant zodiac run, and as it works the industrious bee compute its time as well as we, and how could such sweet and wholesome hours be reckoned but with herbs and flowers? So he says that he's admiring that gardener who's maintaining that garden such a beautiful way. And he says that bees, unlike human beings, they don't have any clock or something to keep the record of time, but they know it very well. How do they understand that? Because you might have, I think you are aware about that hourglass and all, used in the ancient times. Similarly, our skillful gardener has formed such an hourglass using the flowers and trees and plants of the garden. So when the sun passes, around 12 o'clock, sun will be at the center of the, isn't it? It will be right above our head. So by the very shadow that is casted on the plants and trees, one can easily predict the passage of the time. So he says that who can reject the such a soothing, beautiful company of plants and trees in the garden? It is far better than the company of women. You understood this poem? Garden? Hello?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Next poem. It's almost 12. I don't know. I'm rushing, okay? So I told you this man, Andrew Marvell, is an opportunist, because at first he was with Charles Fest after the beheading, after the death of Charles Fest. Charles Fest was beheaded by Oliver Cromwell in 1649. After that, he joined Oliver Cromwell. So in this poem, he is praising Oliver Cromwell, who is returning from Ireland. Let me tell you, Charles Fest was a very merry king. He has only those privileged class enjoyed during his reign. And Oliver Cromwell is a Protestant king, very strict in his ways. He doesn't he didn't encourage any kind of art, music. During his reign, all theaters were closed, shut down in England. Okay, so in this poem, he's justifying Oliver Cromwell for his rigid ways, strict ways. And you can also see that he is also justifying Charles Fest, because this person has worked under both kings. Okay, trying to justify both. He has taken a neutral stand, a diplomatic stand in this poem. So yeah, the first few lines, let's see the first few lines of the poem. The forward youth that would appear must now forsake his muses dear. The forward youth is none but Oliver Cromwell. Charles Fest was a poet who encouraged poets. Okay, Charles Fest, I told you, is a very happy king, jovial king. He encouraged all, he was a womanizer. He encouraged all poets. Another courteous, but this person is is different from him. He says that forward youth that would appear must now forsake his muses dear. Muses means those goddesses who help poets in writing. So he says that actually our Oliver Cromwell was forced to forsake the muses. Why? Why he was forced to forsake the goddess? Nor in shadows sing his slumbers languishing. It's time to leave the books in dust. He says that this person was forced to forsake them. It is time to leave the books in dust. He doesn't have time to read the books. Because unlike other kings of England, England's other kings were very peaceful, peace-loving kings. Elizabeth, James Fest, Charles Fest, etc. They were very interested only in merrymaking things. But this person, unlike them, is a man. Okay. his ancestors or the previous kings and queens having used the armor, but he has taken that armor, unused armor, and thrown books into dust, removing from the wall the corset of the hall. So this person has taken, used all those things unused by other kings and queens of the England. So restless Cromwell could not cease in the inglorious art of the peace. So Cromwell was very restless, very restless. He was very busy, so he could not rest in peace like other king. He could not enjoy the life like other kings. But thorough adventurous war urged this active star. He was a very active star. He was very active in battle. Actually, he was the person who has worked for the common people. One second. Let me take the poem. Just a few seconds. Then see, you cannot blame Oliver Cromwell, because he is the only man who had worked for the common people, because other kings and queens of England, they have worked for the privileged class and they were only interested in uplifting themselves. But he has gifted England to people of England. Okay, his victories may seem to make his usurp ancient rights of the king. Okay, see, this person has done a lot. Then he also justifies the very beheading of Charles Fest by Oliver Cromwell, because when a bigger thing enters a space, lower thing has to make space for it, isn't it? When a bigger person comes, when someone great comes, the lower ones or someone of less importance have to make space for them, isn't it? So just like that, Charles West was someone lower to him. That is why it is a natural phenomena. That is a natural process. Then when the civil war broke out, this person was trapped. This person was able to trap Charles West. Then Charles West was beheaded by Oliver Cromwell. Again, we can see he has taken a switch in the poem where he justifies Charles West just like Oliver Cromwell. He says that Charles Fest is not, he is not second to anyone. Even though he was beheaded by Oliver Cromwell, even at the time of beheading, he met the sword of the Oliver Cromwell with even sharper gaze. Okay, Charles II was not afraid even at the time of his execution. He was also very brave as Oliver Cromwell. And that very act of beheading has terrified the entire England, entire parliament. Actually, this person is not like this person has caused the very shunning of the art, music, theaters in England, and he has a reason for it, because he was busy working for the people. He was busy fighting the battle. He has only brought accolades to England, praises to England, unlike another king who was only bothered about their happiness. Oliver Cromwell was always working for the people. He was always adding provinces to England. He defeated Ireland. Then he is now moving to another Scandinavian countries. So many extended metaphors have been used. It's a long poem. So I'm summarizing it since we don't have enough time. If you have any doubt, you can message me personally. Okay. Now, George Herbert. George Herbert is a priest. Unlike our Andrew Marvel and John Donne, he is a religious poet. He had never penned any sensual or erotic poem. Henry Vaughan called him a most glorious saint. He was born in a rich family, and then all his work were posthumously published, because he hasn't published any of his poems when he was alive. He published, he has written a letter to his friend. in his letters, he asks his friend to read them. He can publish it only if they are eligible enough to be published. Okay, so in 1633, all of his English poems were published in the temple, Sacred Poems and Private Ejaculation, with a preface by Nicolas Ferrer. Now, features of Herbert's poetry: religious themes, puns, brilliant use of conceit, intricate themes. Then this person is pretty famous for writing pattern poems. If you are writing a poem on wings or candle, you will write the poem in the shape of a candle. The lines of the poem will be formed, written in such a way that it will take the shape of a wing or a candle or a rose or a bird. You got it? It's pretty good in writing pattern poems. I told you, pattern poems. In pattern poems, lines of the poem will be written in such a manner that will take the form of the topic of the poem. Okay, so pattern poem is called Carmen Figuratum, altar poem, and emblem poem. It is known by different names. Anyway, let's see the definition. Carmen Figuratum is a Latin expression meaning a shaped poem. The verse of such poems are written in written or printed to form a design on the page. Easter wings. So in Easter wings, he has written the poem in the shape of wings, shape of a wing. In altar poem, the shorter and the longer lines are arranged on the page in the shape of an altar. So let's see now. Yeah. Emblem meaning a book containing pictures. Okay. And the very picture will be the theme of the poem. Common themes in the poetry of George Herbert: dependence, redemption, Christ's martyrdom, man's relationship with God, man's submissiveness to God, reconciliation. So reconciliation is the major theme. It's the major theme of reconciling with God. Man's reconciliation with the God is the major, one of the major theme of the George Herbert's poetry. Okay. Now, see, can you see the shape of this poem? Just look at the shape of this poem, pattern of the poem. It's in the shape of a wing. Can you see this? Hello? Hello?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, yeah.
Yes, ma'am.
This is said to be a pattern poem. One second. So the, yeah, Easter wing. The Easter wing, the poem is written in the shape of a wing. Lord, who creates man in the wealth and store, though foolishly he lost the same, decaying more and more, still he became more poor with thee. Oh, let me rise, oh, as lark, harmoniously, and sing this day thy victories. Then shall the fall further the flight in me. So he says that, again, George Herbert says that God has created man in wealth and store. That means when Adam and Eve was created in the paradise, they enjoyed all luxuries. Due to their own mistake, they lose that amenities. They lost that luxury that they enjoyed. After that, they started to decay day by day. Now, as days pass, they are we human beings are decaying more and more. So, in the coming lines, he says that, "Oh God, let me rise, please lift me up. Let me rise like a lark, a songbird. Let me sing like a songbird. Let me sing your victories just like a songbird." So have you seen whenever the poet is mentioning about God's blessings, he expands the line. The line has been expanded, and you can see the lines have been contracted wherever man falls. When the mistakes are highlighted, lines are getting contracted. When God's blessings are mentioned, it is expanded. So that's the very style of the poem. So in this poem, he's asking the God to forgive him and to give him wings. Give him wings so that he can sing the song, sing praises of the God and fly like a skylark. That is the very gist of the poem. Very easy poem. Okay. Now, collar. Collar is a pun. Okay. Collar has got two meanings. One is the collar worn by the collar of the shirt, of a collar of the priest's suit. Another collar is restriction. I told you there are two meanings, just like ecstasy. Ecstasy has got But ecstasy is a pun, right? Similarly, collar is also a pun. One meaning is the collar of a priest suit. Another meaning is restriction. I struck the board and cried, no more, I will abode. What shall I ever sigh and pie? My lines, life are free and free as... So in this poem, he is very angry because he's very much frustrated after becoming a priest. He's asking, what is the very need of becoming a priest? What I have gained after becoming a priest? Actually, my life was very free, like a road. I had all possible things to enjoy my life. And he's saying, who's there to restrict my me? I still have fruit in front of me. I still can enjoy my life. Have I have no harvest but a thorn? Let me blood, no restore. What I have lost with my cordial fruit. Sure, there was a wine. See, he has wasted all his life by becoming a priest. He says that, oh, there was a wine in front of me. Then in the coming stanza, you can see that he is growing very frustrated. And he says that his life was very happy, but after becoming a priest, he lost all happiness. Towards the end, he gets reconciliated with God after God calls him my child. That's the summary of the caller. I told you, here he is showing his frustration. Because after getting into the priesthood life, he thought priesthood life would be very happy, very enjoyable. But after becoming a priest, he understood the restriction of his profession, because his profession has got lost a lot of restrictions. So he cannot tolerate the restriction of offered by the profession. He wants to come out of his profession, from his robe, from his profession. Okay. Later he understood that he is very near to God. He gets reconciled with the God. Okay, that's a very summary. Then affliction also have the same theme. Same theme of caller, very same theme of the caller, and this is a series of poems, five poems, and affliction one is the first of the series of the five poems. Okay, so here, when I first thou did entice thee my heart, I thought the service brave, so many joys I writ down my part, besides what I might have out of my stock of natural delights and augmented with gracious benefits. So in the first line of this poem, poet says that when I first chose priesthood profession, I thought this profession is full of happiness, full of happiness. That is why I joined. And at first poet, God has given him lot of happiness, blessings. But then he slowly understood that this profession is not full of happiness. Soon he was afflicted with many diseases. Then he lost many of his friends, family members. Just like before, he cannot mingle with his friends, family members and all. After becoming a priest, there are so many restrictions in life. So he lost many this. So he become very rebellious. And he really wants to give up this profession. At that time, God has bribed him. How God has bribed George Herbert to continue in this profession. Actually, God has given him many earthly honors. This person is very educated. He's pedantic. So by giving honors, earthly honors, God forced him to remain in this profession. So thus God, even though God has afflicted him many diseases, God has given him, again God has given him many diseases so that he won't enter an earthly life, gout, many other paralysis, like that he has given, God has given him many diseases, to continue in this profession. Then he understood that the best way to get reunited with the God is through undergoing many afflictions. One can get, see, you can cleanse your heart, you can cleanse yourself, you can make yourself pure only undergoing through sufferings. You have to undergo suffering if you want to reunite with the God. Affliction means spiritual suffering. Okay, that is the meaning of this poem. Okay, so he says that first he was drawn into the profession thinking about the good sides of the priesthood profession. But when he entered the professionally, he understood the picture is not as rosy as it appears. At first, he was very happy with the profession. Later, he lost many of his friends, family members. He became sick. and he became very rebellious. God has given him some earthly honors, education, knowledge and all. Again, even though he was still he was not happy with the profession, then God has given him many diseases, so has to continue in this profession. Then he understood God has purposely given him that painful situation, so has to cleanse himself, so has to get him close with the God. That's a theme of affliction. One second. Love is also a very beautiful poem by George Herbert, a spiritual poem. Here also, love is God. The metaphysical conceit is love is God. Love has been personified as God. And poet, love bade me welcome you, yet my soul drew back, guilt of dust and sin. But quick-eyed love, observing me grow slack from my first entrance in, drew nearer to me, sweatly questioning if I lack anything. A guess I answer worthy to be there. Here, love said, you shall be he. You shall be he. I think unkind, ungrateful. Ah, my dear, I cannot look at on thee. Look, love took my hand and smiling did reply, who made the eyes but I? So in this poem, he says that he has committed many mistakes. After his death, he's about to enter someone's house. Love's house. Love is none but God. He wants to meet the God, but he has committed many mistakes, sin. He is so reluctant to get in touch with God. So he is standing next near to the God's house, and he wants to meet him. So I guess I answered worthy to be here. Love said, you shall be here. So even though he has committed many mistakes, he says that he cannot look upon the God because he has, due to his prick of consciousness, guilty conscience, he cannot look at God. Then God asked him, who gave you the eyes? It's me, right? So God can forgive for all our mistakes because Jesus Christ has carried the cross, or he had carried that burden for the goodness of the mankind. He has sacrificed his own life. So he said that I'm there for you. So this poem is again a reconciliation with God. Love is the God. Now, Puli. This poem is also, again, Puli is a pun here. One Puli, that is, you know what a Puli is, isn't it? The Puli that we use to fetch things up, isn't it? Just like that. Puli is the thing that we use to fetch things up. So there is a story here, a Greek myth here. I think you are familiar with Zeus and all, isn't it? Zeus. Do you know who is the person who brought fire to earth? Hello, class. Do you know who is the person that brought fire to earth? Somebody? Are you people over there? Hello?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So it is Prometheus who brought fire to earth. Actually, previously, only God and goddesses enjoyed the divine thing, fire. It is Prometheus who gifted mankind with fire. Since fire was a divine thing, Zeus became very angry. He punished Prometheus. Prometheus was chained to a mountain. And during morning time, his eyes, his liver, his heart will be devoured by vulture. And during night time, it will grow back. Zeus was not yet happy with the punishment given to the Zeus. He again planned to punish human beings now who are enjoying the gift of fire. So he created a beautiful lady named Pandora. Pandora. So he almost all gods have gifted Pandora many things. And she had God blessing from all gods like Zeus, Vesta, Poseidon, many Greek gods. Last, Zeus have gifted her a box. And Zeus told Pandora not to open the box. Box under any situation, and she was sent to earth. After creating Pandora, after giving many blessings and a box, Zeus sent Pandora to earth. Okay, so she forgot about her previous situation and all. She married to an earthly man, and after leading a happy life for some years, she became very curious about the box gifted by Zeus, and she was now thinking why Zeus has told her not to open the box. Obviously, human being will have that curiousness, isn't it? Curiousness to open. When we are told not to do something, we will do that first, isn't it? Similarly, Pandora has opened the box. All the evils came out of that box. Okay, all the evils came out of the box. And it is believed that after opening that box only, greed, lust, diseases, sadness, sorrow came on earth. Okay. So, but let me tell you, but Zeus has put last thing, hope, or rest in the box. So here, the George Herbert says that God has given all blessings to mankind, or everything to mankind, withholding something, that is rest. Okay, let us check this poem. When God at first made man, having a glass of blessing standing by, let us said he pour on him all we can, let the world's riches which disperse lie contract into span. So when God first created man, he has blessed man with a glass box. He has poured one by one all gifts in it. So strength first made a way, the beauty followed, the wisdom, honor, pleasure. When almost all was out, God made us ray, perceive that all this treasure rest in bottom lay. So he has given gifts one by one. What are the gifts given by God? Beauty, wisdom, strength, pleasure. He has given man everything. At that moment, he stopped. Why? If man gets all gifts, he won't appreciate God anymore, isn't it? If man is enjoying all the benefits, all the gift that is enjoyed by the God, will he ever worship the God? No. Will he get closer to the God? No. So for that reason, he withhold the gift of rest. So the punishment that God given to the man or the for the greediness of the man is restlessness. So one may try to amass whatever thing he wants in life. Man will never become satisfied. He will be restless. So that restless will raise him, will pull him like a pulley, will elevate him to the God, isn't it? If we have some sorrow, if we have some sadness, then only we will remind God. Then only we will pray to God, invoke God. So God has withheld the gift of restlessness in order to make man closer to the God. So in this poem, George Herbert says that restlessness is the pulley used by the God to uplift the man towards him. Have you understood the meaning, gist of this poem, class? Hello?
Thank you, ma'am.
Okay. Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am. Okay. Redemption. Another poem. So redemption. Here, he compares God to a tenant, and he is a peasant. Poet is the peasant, and God is the God is the landowner. God is the landowner, and poet is the tenant. Okay. So having been tenant long to a rich lord, not thriving, I resolved to behold and make a suit unto him to afford and a new small rented lease and cancel the old. So let me tell you, when the poem starts, the poet says that he was a tenant to a rich lord. Poet was a tenant to a rich lord. Actually, our poet is the servant of a god. And what happened to him? Not thriving, I resolved. Actually, he hasn't become successful in the business, job he has done. So he wants to cancel the contract with the landlord, and he wanted to start a new contract. In ancient times, we know that there was a tenant landlord, they'll be having a contract. After the end of the year, they will have to give the profit to the landlord, isn't it? Some share to the landlord. So this person was not successful in his business. So he wanted to meet the God and ask forgiveness for not becoming successful. And he also wanted to start a new contract. So here, rich lord is the God, tenant or the farmer is the poet. Okay, so he started. He wanted to meet God has to cancel the bond and to renew the contract. So he started his journey and he went to God's house. That is to heaven. When he went there, his family members, I mean God's other gods, said that God is not there. He has gone to some foreign lands. He has gone to some land which he had dearly brought. That means he had gone to earth which he had dearly brought long since on earth to take possession. It speaks about the creation of earth. When he went to heaven, he got the information that God is not in the heaven, but God has been to where? Earth, isn't it? Jesus Christ is not in the heaven, but he has come down to earth to live with his dear ones. And in coming lines, you can see that, when the poet went in search for the God on earth, he was surrounded by many thieves. That is about the crucifixion phase, isn't it? During the crucifixion time, Jesus Christ was at the center, and on his either side, there were two thieves, isn't it? Similarly, when Jesus Christ was at the center, he was circled by a lot of thieves. At that time, our tenant approached the rich Lord, asking to cancel the contract. Anyway, at the time of the death, at the time of rich Lord's death, he has granted the last request of the poet, isn't it? At the time of the crucifixion, Jesus Christ has cured many sick people, isn't it? Similarly, his last wish also granted by the God. So again, he appreciates or praises the sacrifice of the Jesus Christ of God. Now, Window is also a very beautiful poem. Window is the metaphor used in the poem. Okay, you can see, Lord, how can man preach thy eternal word? He is brittle, crazy glass. Yet in thy temple thou doth him afford this glorious transcendent place to be a window through thy grace. But when thou doth anneal in glass thy story, making thy life to shine within the holy preachers, then the light glory more reverent grows and more doth win, which else shows waterish bleaky thin. So let me tell you, he says that church is the God or Jesus Christ, and window is the human beings. Window is the human being. So a normal man is like a brittle glass. A glass, when falls, it will break, isn't it? Similarly, a weak man is like a glass. But haven't you seen the window glasses in the churches? Okay, you can see colored glasses engraved with stories, isn't it? If you have been to churches, or at least those people have gone to churches, they can see church glasses, window glasses with a lot of biblical stories, colored window glasses. So he says that man, originally he is brittle, is a big mistake, but see, you can get reunited with God if you undergo through great pain. So let's see this. Lord, how can man preach thy eternal word? He's asking how you can suppose that man can preach your story. For preaching Jesus Christ's story or eternal story, one needs great patience. One needs great faith, isn't it? Yet in thy temple thou doth him afford. That means, see, I am not that perfect or pure. Still you have afforded me in your place. That means our George Herbert is a priest, isn't it? He's a priest. That is why he said that I am a window of your church. Window means God is the church, window is the poet. You understood? Have you understood that meta comparison? Church is the God, window is the poet. So previously he was a normal window, a normal glass, which would break if it is fallen. Okay, this glorious and transcendent place to be a window through thy grace. Okay, I have become the window of this church through thy grace. But when thou doth anneal in the glass thy story, see, if you want to engrave, if you want to inscribe those stories on the church windows, then you have to anneal the glasses. Anneal means heat the glass. If you heat the glass only, you'll be able to inscribe those stories in the glasses. So one has to undergo through great pain and pressure, then only he will become pure. Similarly, man has to cleanse his soul, purify himself, so has to get the blessing of the God. Anyway, our poet is very much blessed because God has chosen him to be the window of his church. I hope you understood the poem. Now, the last poem is Aaron. Aaron, actually, let me tell you, Aaron is the I mean a priest mentioned in the Old Testament. Okay, Aaron is a type of priest described in the Old Testament. He was Moses' brother. In the book of Exodus, there is a description of robe worn by Aaron is given. So Aaron is taken as the perfect priest. He has got a ceremonial robe, and he has got two valuable gems on his chest, Thummim and Urmim, and he has got a bell. Wherever he goes, when he rings the bell, people can easily understand that Aaron is coming. So Aaron is the perfect model of a priest. I told you Aaron is a type of priest mentioned in Old Testament, brother of Moses. And in the book of Exodus, a description about his ceremonial robe is given. So I told you he's a role model for all priests, perfect priest. But George Herbert is also a priest. He says that he is not as perfect as Aaron. Because let's see the poem. Holiness on the head, light and perfection on the breast, harmonious bells below, raising the dead to let them unto life rest, and thus are true Aaron's rest. So in the first stanza, he describes a perfect priest, how an Aaron should be, how a priest should be. There should be holiness on the head of the priest, and there should be light and perfection in their chest. Wherever they go, when they rings the bell, the dead will be raised from their grave, and they will give eternity to those souls. That should be the very responsibility of a perfect Aaron. Okay, Aaron mentioned in the old Bible. Profaneness in my head, defects and darkness in my breast, a noise of passion ringing me for dead, unto a place where is no rest. Poor priest, thus I am dressed. So let me tell you, here he compares Aaron to himself. See, actually the role model of Aaron, we have a perfect priest we have seen, but he is entirely different from that perfect priest. If holiness on the Aaron's head, what I have on my head is profaneness. I have committed many mistakes. Instead of light and perfection, what I have in my breast is defect and darkness. I have lot of imperfection. Then a noise of passion of ringing me for dead. I can hear the sound of dead people. When Aaron's move with the bell, dead people raise from the grave. But when I move, I'm feared about death. Unto a place where is no rest. I'm feared about the restlessness. Poor priest, thus I am dressed. So I am not that celestially dressed or ceremoniously dressed as an Aaron. I have many defects, unlike a perfect priest. So then, just a second, let me go through the last lines of the poem. Aaron. Yeah. So in the fourth stanza, if you have a textbook, only another head, I have another heart, breast, another music, making life or not dead, without whom I could have no rest. In him I am well dressed. So since heart of the poem, that is the heart of the poem, only another head. See, since I am in your place, since I am in the church, I have been, I have another heart and another. Now I have another heart. You are in me. God is in me. Okay, even though I am not as perfect as the priest mentioned in the Bible, you are in me. As long as you are in me, I am not dead. Okay, Christ is my only head, my alone only heart, breast, my only music striking even dead, that to the old man I may rest, I be in new breast. As long as Christ, I believe in Christ, or Christ is in me, I am not afraid of anything. So here, Aaron, or the robe, is the Aaron. He compares himself to the biblical priest. Then the dress is the God. Okay. Then one more thing. Person is Christ himself. He describes Jesus Christ has the high priest. Human beings are basically sinful, but he has replaced the former self with the new identity. our poet has replaced himself with the formal former identity with what, putting new cloth, and the new cloth is nothing but Jesus Christ. You understood? Aaron has a ceremonial robe, but our George Herbert doesn't have any precious gems, bell, or suit like biblical Aaron, but Jesus Christ has gifted him. And who's the high priest of the world? It is Jesus Christ. Okay, so that's the end of the class. So we have completed somewhat 27 poems in this session. Do you have any doubts? And let me ask you, why the number is coming down after each session? Do you have any problem in understanding the poem? We have a limitation because I told you we have 100 plus poem in this paper. Yes, please.
We are very happy with your class, ma'am. Very, very happy.
No, I'm asking. I'm just puzzled. In the first day of the class, I somewhat 95 students were there. Last class, 60. Now the number had lowered to 40 or 40 plus.
Maybe some other issues because it is a Sunday. May they have some other problem, but not because of.
No, let me ask you: have you understood at least outline of these 27 poems?
Yes, ma'am.
Definitely, ma'am. Definitely.
Yes, of course, ma'am.
Okay. See, the best and the easiest way to master these 27 poems is don't mug up these poems. If you mug up, you will definitely forget this poem. So better go through the features of George Herbert poetry, Andrew Marvell's poetry, and John Donne's poetry, because they all have used some unique techniques in their style. Because first one, John Donne has treated all his poem in a particular way, that because he has the ability to treat spiritual and physical themes alike. Then Andrew Marvell, an opportunist, carpe diem theme, misogynistic theme, too good. Now George Herbert, pure religious poet. And one more thing, most important theme of his poetry is reconciliation with God. Okay then, see you next week with block 4.
Ma'am, from examination point of view, is there any specific point that we have to concentrate more on or something like that?
Oh, no dear. I mean, because you can expect any poem out of this 27. The best way is study the features. Actually, you needn't have to study the poems individually. Just read the poem at least once, because these poems are very simple and very simple, isn't it? But yes, you must master the features, what a metaphysical conceit is. Next one, hyperbole, imagery, irony, conceit, wit, like that. Okay, if you read the poem, you will get the answer. Okay, then bye.
Thank you. Thank you so much.